We're judging the world and saying what sucks. We're reviews versus the world.
Lights are hot.
Brady, what do you call an Irish woman with no arms and legs sitting on your front porch?
I don't know.
Patio furniture.
Oh, beautiful.
Oh, my God. Okay. I've never heard that one.
The rest of these have been gold, and y'all just been like, funny.
No, that's the one that I liked the best.
Okay. Oh, goodness gracious. And welcome to this month's Reviews versus the World podcast.
Patio furniture.
Today we're going to be talking about something that is pretty much the only thing that I've been able to think about since March 3rd.
Ice cream.
Yes.
March Madness.
Oh, yeah, that.
Yeah,
because when you think of Brady, you think of college sports. Anyway.
I think of swears.
We're going to be talking a lot about Zelda today, but before we get into that, we need to find out a little bit about what we have been into. So, Steven, what have you been into for the last month?
So many comics, you guys. It's always comics with me. Last week was Salt Lake's Fan X, which is Comic-Con Lite. It's basically the same thing, just less of it. And there were a lot of crazy good deals there, so I bought a lot of books. I have the complete run of Louise Simonson's Power Pack, which is about four kids, the oldest is 12, who get superheroes, or get superpowers. They get superpowers given to them by a white pony from space. And then they go out and make friends with Cloak and Dagger, because those are good role models for children.
Fellow kids.
Well, they are coming on to ABC Family.
They are. Oh, they're coming on to ABC Family? They got their superpowers from a bad batch of heroin.
I thought they were test subjects.
It's going to be.
For a bad batch of heroin.
It's going to be Tyler Long in the ABC.
Oh, my gosh. I got an omnibus collection of Crisis on Infinite Earths signed by Marv Wolfman. So that's pretty cool. Got some Generation X. I got the Punisher story where Punisher gets turned into a Frankenstein monster. Looking forward to reading that. But the thing that I've been reading the most and want to especially draw to people's attention is a comic book adaptation of Richard Stark's Parker the Hunter. It's a noir novel about a hitman who decides to take revenge on some of the mobsters that ruined his life. This was adapted for comics, this and a couple of other books in the series, by the late, great Darwin Cook. So it looks fantastic. I just finished Parker the Hunter. I'm reading the Outfit now, which I believe is the second book in the series. And so far I'm not liking it quite as much, but it's really good. If you have any affection at all for noir, you should read this, because it's got some just really stunning atmospheric art. Very, like, loose, very rough, very sketchy, which isn't Darwin Cook's usual style. But it's just really well done. The story is excellent. The original novel must have been quite good. Coupled with Darwin Cook's art, it's fantastic. I have enjoyed it immensely.
Nice.
Yep.
All right, Aldo.
So apart from playing 3 days of Horizon Zero Dawn, because it came out 3 days before what we're playing or talking about today, I've been mostly into comics as well. I haven't started to pick up. I've actually just been picking up my whole backlog of comics that's been building up for 6 months. So I've been reading through Ultimate Spider-Man and Spider-Gwen.
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
Because they intersect at some point. They start dating, and that's going to be weird.
It's a little weird, yeah.
Yeah, so I've been going through that. There's skipped over, like, all of Civil War, too. So there's, like, a lot of gaps reading the individual titles, and I was just like, okay. I've been playing that, been playing a little bit of Shovel Knight on the Switch, and I've been watching some movies, specifically the Rurouni Kenshin trilogy, which I heard were excellent adaptations. They're live-action adaptations of specific story arcs from the anime from way back, like, in the 90s. That's weird to say that, way back in the 90s.
It's true, though.
Yeah. So I've been playing those, and I've been watching those, and they're really good. they stick to the whole aesthetic. So you do have like a guy that's entirely bandaged up. You have a guy that's walking around with a sword two times the size of his own body. Kenshin is extremely well acted. He plays aloof a lot of the time, and he does that well. But when they do the fight scenes, you can get a real sense of intensity from the actor and the scenes themselves. So it's been good. But other than that, just 90% Zelda.
So going back a little bit to Shovel Knight.
Yeah.
I've heard really good things about Spectre of Torment. How is it?
I haven't played that. So I've never played Shovel Knight.
So you're playing the base game.
So I'm playing base game.
Yeah.
So they have the Treasure Trove collection on the Switch. And that's what I picked up. So it has Spectre of Torment. And it has Plague Knight, I think is the other one.
Yeah, what was it called? Plague of Something. Shadows.
They gave
Shadows
them all new names.
Yeah. So it has those, and it has Shovel Knight. So it has everything in it. So I've just been playing through the base game, trying to get, you know, the vanilla experience, per se.
So, wait. Does your Switch play other games? Because mine just does the one.
I don't know. Like, I didn't realize.
You gotta pay extra for it.
Uh-huh, okay.
I mean, it's really hard to turn off the one.
Yeah,
but
I just...
once you can get that past that, there's a whole interface and everything.
Are there games? You try to pull anything else up, and it says, do you want to close The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild? And you look at it, you're like, no, I don't.
You're a person with a conscience. You know the right answer.
Surprisingly enough, it stays on the console if you close it. I don't want to risk
what?
It.
Wow.
That's what I've been into.
Very cool. John.
I can't remember the other comic I was reading. Oh, right. Okay. Sorry. I wanted to write it down before I forgot. I do not have a Nintendo Switch.
Boo. Yeah, me neither. Okay. We'll be the Switchless in this together.
We do have three like Switches at this cast. Table
yeah,
right now.
Yeah, there's three Switches in this room.
So I've been watching Iron Fist.
I didn't want to talk about that.
I think we have to.
Well, now
it's
we do.
Better than Luke Cage.
Better than the last half of Luke Cage.
Yeah, I
wait,
at least
Luke
wanted
Cage gets
to finish
worse?
Luke Cage.
Oh, no.
I don't. I'm like
I finished
seven
Luke
episodes.
Cage. I don't bother. It
I,
just
I don't want to.
They have so much. That's the. I think that's what the problem is with Luke Cage and with Iron Fist. Potentially, greatest show ever. Really cool, like, you know, street level hero crime. Lots of, like, you know, excuses to do cool action. You know, they have interesting powers that, you know, they're not going to overpower anybody, but they also can hold their own in a fight, and so it's interesting, and then eventually they're going to be paired up, and because Daredevil was so good, and Jessica Jones was so good, and Daredevil, second season, yes it was.
Jessica Jones was terrible.
David Tennant was a wonderful
Aldo has
in
the
it.
Purple mic, that's why he's saying that it was terrible.
Daredevil is like the only decent thing they've produced on Netflix.
Oh, shoot. Series of Unfortunate Events.
Well, I mean,
see, I can't get. I gotta watch it. I gotta like keep going with that because I can't get. I loved the movie. Loved the movie.
I like.
They're really similar.
The
they're both seem like they're good adaptations, and they're both like the style seems really close, and so yeah. I can't stop comparing the two.
Well, it's the same.
Yeah,
a lot of the same production team. Yeah.
So there's that. I'm slogging through Iron Fist. I think I should finish it because I still have that voice. Like, well, maybe it'll be good. Maybe they'll actually go to Kunlun, and you can see.
Spoiler alert!
You know,
it's not good.
Oh.
Like, this has been critically panned. Iron Fist, of all of the characters who have been adapted for Netflix shows, Iron Fist is the one that I actually owned comics of.
Yeah,
I didn't own
I just
any Daredevil
the Ed
comics.
Ed Brubaker and Matt Fraction.
Oh my gosh, that is so good!
It's so good!
It's so good!
I got Aja's art. It's amazing.
Yeah,
amazing.
But
Aja, Aja,
yeah.
AJA, however you pronounce that, I'm probably butchering it. It's amazing.
Yeah, and so they've got this really great story that they can draw on. Iron Fist is a character who's like fist lights on fire when he punches people.
But in the show, he just has a glowing fist that sometimes does stuff. And it's like, why is it only one? Why is it only sometimes? Why isn't he put? No, it's just.
I'm not even gonna lie. Between Jessica Jones and Luke Cage, I don't even want to watch Iron Fist. And any shred of excitement I had for the Defenders is gone.
But Daredevil will be in it, and Punisher will be in it.
They've DC'd me.
Oh, they've DC'd you. Ooh. Ooh.
Oh, yeah.
But that'll be our thing. It's like we all remember where we were when we saw Batman v Superman.
So here's my thing about Iron Fist. Just, like, everything about it is, is like understated to the point where it's like you're going somewhere with this, right? No, they're not. It just stays stagnant, especially his character. Now, I understand that Iron Fist should be, I guess, a little bit soft-spoken, but the way that he plays it is like way to the extreme where it's like there's no personality behind him. There's nothing there that I can attach on to. I'm only 4 episodes in, and I can't.
It's about where I am at, too.
Iron Fist should be where Bruce Wayne is, except all the time. He's supposed to be kind of a loud, rambunctious playboy in and out of the costume.
So completely the opposite of anything in the show.
See, I'm glad you said it that way. I was just going to say they half-assed it. But what you said was better and more critically.
I think, honestly, one of the biggest problems with Iron Fist is the villain. Or the villains, because say what you want about Jessica Jones and Luke Cage. I think I like them better than Aldo and perhaps John did.
John.
But I know. I'm getting wrapped up with the next.
Brady, we need name tags.
On it.
But I mean, like,
You've
Jessica
been to
Jones.
My house.
Jessica Jones has David Tennant as the Purple Man. Luke Cage had Cottonmouth.
Kinda. Like, he was only, like, kind of good, and it was building and building and building.
Oh, Cottonmouth was awesome.
I liked the actor. I
thought Cottonmouth was great. I thought, they call her Black Mariah in the comics. I don't know what they call her in the... She was an interesting actress, at least. Is that Alfred Woodard who played her? Yeah.
She was good in Star Trek.
But Iron Fist, the villains are just so, like, limp... So, sauceless lasagna noodles—they're just bland.
You can tell that the actress who plays Madame Gao, like, she was great in Daredevil, great in Daredevil. Mm-hmm. But then, they're just giving her crap material.
The
to
character
work with.
Is not interesting in Iron Fist at
and
all.
And she's like the most interesting thing, you know, like what's going on in Daredevil. And you're like, is she connected to Iron Fist? That'll be interesting.
I was expecting her to be like really... from one of the Seven Cities of Heaven.
That's what I thought.
With
is she not? I thought she
I
was
don't know.
Crane Mother or something. Is
Maybe
she
she's Crane Mother, but Crane Mother. Supposed to be interesting.
So moving away from that garbage heap, I've gotten the bug. There's a lost episode of our podcast where we had the Legendarium podcast guys over. They were nice enough to come and explain fantasy to us and talk about fantasy novels and the whole genre. And it was a wonderful podcast that just has disappeared into the ether somewhere. Which is too bad. Mostly it turned into a Brandon Sanderson love fest towards the end, which I found out why. I've been hooked. I bought Mistborn, The Final Empire, the first Mistborn novel on September 16th, and have since read nine books. So it's almost like a book a month or more of just, it's only $8 on the Kindle. Okay, next. Someone told me, okay, if you're getting into Brandon Sanderson, read the books in this order, because eventually they'll all connect. Oh, really? And I read Well of Ascension, Hero of Time, Alloy of Law, Shadows of Self, Bands of Mourning, Elantris, Warbreaker, and now I'm on the Stormlight Archives, and I'm only, halfway through, and it's amazing. And
So I got to find out, who's your favorite character so far in Way of Kings?
Oh, Kaladin. Yeah.
Kaladin?
Yeah.
Oh, Dalinar, man.
No, Dalinar is wonderful. But
Dalinar.
It's been like 1,000 pages since I heard from him, so I've forgotten all about him. It's so big. It's such a huge book. I'm like reading and reading, and like the Kindle tells you how many percentage of the way through you are. I'm like, wow, I've been reading for days. It's like you get up to, the halfway point on Everest. You're like, whew, can't be much longer. 21%. What? So... loving that, and in my Marvel Unlimited app, I've been catching up on Doctor Strange and Vision, which are fantastic.
Yeah.
Those are ones I'm going to... I forget the writer now, but Chris Piccolo is drawing for Doctor Strange, and it's amazing. So I'm going to buy that trade. I'm going to buy the Visions. I think it's done, right?
Vision's done.
12 and out.
Vision's done, yes.
Yeah. It's fantastic.
Uh-huh.
And I did not know anything about that character, didn't care about the character. I was like, that'll be interesting in the movie. Great, fine.
Isn't it Vision with a family that he created in the suburbs?
Yep.
Okay.
That was one of my top picks for 2016 because it was so dang good.
It's like the... I don't know. I can't compare it to anything except like that first... oh my gosh, I'm blanking. That first like Matt Fraction run on Hawkeye, where it's like you're taking this character that no one cares about and suddenly like creating this incredible book.
That's been Marvel's business model ever since Hawkeye happened.
Since Iron Man the movie happened, I think you could argue.
Yeah.
That's the one where he has Pizza Dog, right?
Yeah, that's the Hawkeye one.
Vision has a dog. Not quite the same.
No. And also, I'm still behind, so don't spoil anything, Brady, but Legion.
Oh, gosh.
Legion is what I wish the Marvel Netflix shows had been, because it's cool.
It is and amazing and so beautifully shot.
The
last episode that I watched, episode 6, I still haven't watched episode 7 either, but it has this dance number from Aubrey Plaza that's so good.
She's in the beginning and then she disappears for a couple episodes, and then when she comes back, it's like, whoa, I'm glad you're in this show. This is so cool what I'm seeing. It's amazing. And I didn't see it coming. And it's one of those where I think they have a plan. You know the Lost effect where you're like, wow, what's going to happen next? Wow, what's going to happen next? And then no payoff.
Oh, Noah Hawley has plans. That's what he does.
I think it's going to be really sweet because you get that whole like, I have no idea what's going on, but I'm loving the ride. So that's what I've been into.
Cool. Chris. Welcome, Chris. This is your second time on the podcast.
Yeah. Hey, everybody.
Down the mountain to be here.
Yeah, we
shield boarded down the mountain to be here.
Thanks for holding off on, thanks for waiting for me. We had a ward talent show, so church talent show that was very exciting. My wife and I sang Dear Theodosia, which was
nice.
Fun. Aww. Yeah, it was good. Lately I we'll get to what I've been spending all of my free time on. I will say, well, no, I'll save this for the next part. But yeah, I've really been in a rut as far as video games go for quite a while. I moved to a new house in June, and I mostly play on PC, and my PC doesn't currently have a screen hooked up to it. It's just serving as a server, and so it's just kind of sitting there, and I haven't really played that much. And so the Switch has been a revelation. I will play everything on it. I play a ton just in bed, like watching TV and then sometimes on the TV. But, you know, some of you guys have kids. Like, you understand you don't own the TV anymore. The TV is no longer yours. So
I cannot possibly relate.
Yeah. So Switch is very exciting. I'm really excited to hear that there are other games, apparently. I do have one non-Zelda related thing, which is that I've been playing Snipper Clips.
Oh, I love Snipper Clips.
Yeah.
Love Snipper Clips.
Played through most of the 2-player levels, almost all of the 4-player levels. I've been playing with my 5-year-old, which is extremely challenging. I'm going to call that Snipper Clips hard mode.
So my 5-year-old, when we play Snipper Clips together, she likes to just randomly, like, she'll be participating and just right there with you.
Oh, no.
And then all of a sudden she'll get in a mood where she's just like, I'm just going to snip you away constantly.
Oh, yeah. That's how I played the game. It's all about, like, do you remember Battletoads on the NES?
It had friendly fire.
My favorite thing about that game was picking up a stick and hitting player two with it. Yeah. And that's Snipper Clips for me. Oh, it's the same thing.
So, Chris, for those who might not know what we're talking about right now, I'd be like, clipping you away. What's that? can you explain a little bit about what Snipper Clips is?
Snipper Clips is this amazing, I forget where it's from, but a couple of like Swedish guys, I think, made it, and it showed up at a game jam like 3 years ago. It's this game where you play in cooperative multiplayer with another person or with three other people, and you are pieces of paper that have the ability to cut each other into various shapes. And so you kind of overlay with the person, and then whatever is overlaid, you can cut away from the other person. That's the best explanation I can do on audio. Just go look it up. You know, we'll get some B-roll or something.
It's crazy. And
the only problem is when they showed up to the convention, nobody had an Allen wrench to make the Swedish game work. So
they needed Nintendo.
So essentially it showed up at this game jam. Then no one ever heard from it again until Nintendo did the Switch announcement. And lo and behold, it's now a first-party Nintendo title being produced by Nintendo. And so it is, I would call it, I mean, besides Breath of the Wild, obviously, probably the most talked about kind of big surprise from the Switch.
Oh, yeah.
I've heard
kind of, I heard an argument the other day that like maybe that should have been the pack-in title. You know, it really kind of works really well on the Switch. You can play it on the go.
Yeah, it really plays well into the whole ethos of the system, which is that it's a portable multiplayer system.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Like, when was the last time you bought a console that came with two controllers? Ever?
The NES?
Ever in the
United States?
No, yeah.
I don't think the NES did.
Yeah. John, I think the day I got my Switch, maybe, or a little after, we went out for pizza, and I was showing off the Switch, and they were like, oh, cool, like, what does it do? And I just handed out four controllers, and we played Snipper Clips, like, at the pie, like, eating pizza, just playing on the table. And it was
that easy.
Yeah, it was just
all you need.
It was just like a Nintendo commercial. so that's been excellent. I'm really excited about the Switch. I've been really looking forward to a console like this for 2 or 3 years. And as soon as that announcement, I remember waking up and seeing that first announcement video, and it was like, this is exactly what I want. Like, I don't care how much it is. I will throw my money at you. Like, just give it to me. It has not disappointed. So besides that, which I'm sure we'll get to a lot more later, the only really other geeky thing I can think of that I've been doing besides playing Zelda is that I picked up Amazing Spider-Man number 25 the other day, and the reason for that is that it has a story from Hannah Blumenreich. Does that
Not ringing a bell with me? Who is this?
Okay, so Hannah Blumenreich is an artist and writer that started writing Spider-Man comics like a year ago and just putting them up on the web, and just they're these wonderful go look her up. There are these wonderful, like, Peter Parker stories. You know, it's Peter Parker is a young kid living with Aunt May. Aunt May is, like, 100% in on the, you know, the fact that he's Spider-Man. She's knitting him sweaters and, like, is this amazing, adorable thing.
So here's a comic with Peter Parker putting on his costume, and he's wearing earbuds, and now he is swinging through New York singing Leonard Nimoy's Bilbo Baggins song.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
I love one where Aunt May is like, now it's going to be cold out. Like, May, I can't. Oh. And so he has a coat on over his Spider-Man outfit.
Oh, yeah, she's knit him a sweater, and she's like, oh, don't worry. I made it with your quote-unquote look in mind. And so it shows him pulling it out of the bag, and like he has this sour look on his face, and then his face just lightens up, and the next panel is him in like the classic Spider-Man swinging, and he's in the red and blue outfit with this big baggy black sweater with the black costume logo.
Oh yeah, I'm looking at that right now. It's actually pretty great.
It's really fantastic. Great art, actually.
This is super charming stuff.
Yeah, it's amazing. Oh, she's got a.
He's watching Gilmore Girls.
Yeah,
this is my favorite thing that has ever existed.
That's why I'm surprised you didn't know about it.
This is actually so I have seen these because it's the one where the girl is walking down the street and he just walks with her.
Right, like she kind of gets hassled by some guys in the street, and so he just walks her home and like rides the subway home with her.
She's
and
perfect to ride like, Spider-Man. Yeah, she really gets the character.
He's like telling this random girl all about, I want to say it's Cowboy Bebop.
Yes. Actually, I'm wearing a Cowboy Bebop shirt right now.
So, you ever seen Cowboy Bebop? What's that, like a band?
It's excellent.
Far from it, Jen.
Yeah, I've been very excited about her for a long time, and something like 2 or 3 months ago, she posted art. So she has a page. Patreon. She has something called the Spidey Zine on Gumroad that you should check out. It's free. Like, definitely go get it. And she, on her Twitter 2 or 3 or 4 months ago, just said, it was on New Year's Day or New Year's Eve. She just said, so looks like next year I'm going to be writing Spider-Man for Marvel. And so they gave her basically like a little 4 or 5 page one shot in the big Amazing Spider-Man number 25 that just came out Wednesday, and it is fantastic. It's like he finds a dog in the street, and I won't spoil it for you, but go and check it out. It's the first physical comic I've purchased in years, honestly.
I also pick up Spider-Man amongst all the comics I pick up. So I didn't know that, but now that you said that, I'm probably going to go home and just pull that one out because I haven't gotten to that one yet in the backlog.
It's great, and I haven't even read like the rest of it. I just flipped to the middle like and read it with my daughter. It was great. It's really, really great.
Just read Spidey Zine. It's amazing. It didn't take long.
No, same. We were doing the same thing.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, definitely go check that out. That's what I've been doing.
Very cool. Well, basically, I have just been doing Zelda. Really, that's pretty much been pretty much it for me. Other than that, I mean, I have been watching Legion, as we mentioned before, and it's absolutely awesome. If you have not watched it yet, please go and watch it. Steven, did you watch it?
Steven still catching up from 2014.
That'd be a no. And I did finish up Harmon Quest.
Oh, yeah.
I've only seen the first episode and a half, because that's all I could find on YouTube.
Oh, it's wonderful. If you don't know what Harmon Quest is, so Dan Harmon, he is the creator of Community, and he's the co-creator of Rick and Morty. So if those kind of are your bag, then this is probably for you. It's he and celebrities and friends get together to play a role-playing game, like a tabletop role-playing game, and then they go and they animate it. So, like, they animate the conversation of what's happening, and it is hilarious, it is wonderful. Nathan Fillion's in one episode, and he's really great. Aubrey Plaza's in an episode, and she's absolutely hilarious.
Chelsea Peretti. Paul F. Tompkins does the first one. I love Paul F. Tompkins. It was so funny.
Kumail Nanjiani, who's one of my favorites. He's in one of the episodes. It's absolutely hilarious. The first episode is free on YouTube. If you haven't watched it, go and just watch that first episode, see if it's something that's for you. And if you laugh in that first episode, you will laugh every episode. So something that did not make me laugh is I'm always, you know, there are certain animes that have appealed to me over the years. And
over the year, maybe.
No, it's been two.
Okay, fine.
That's plural. And one of them that I actually really liked, even though it does have the awful fan service that you get in a lot of animes, is Seven Deadly Sins on Netflix. And I really enjoyed the first season. And then I'm like, oh, I hope that they come out with the second season sometime soon. And this last month, they came out with the second season. Or at least I thought it was a second season, but it was just four freaking episodes that had nothing to do with the main storyline of where they were going at the end of season one, and I was pissed.
That's about how Attack on Titan fans felt after Attack on Titan Junior High happened.
That's really a thing?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, jeez.
It's really funny. It's actually kind of cute. It's a weird trend that they have in Japan to take these big, epic, super serious series and then put them in Junior High.
Like AVX Babies.
Yeah.
That's a great Scotty Young.
Valiant High. That happened too.
One of the most depressing and confusing anime ever has its own junior high one, which is Evangelion.
Oh.
It's everybody's depressed, everybody wants to die, and there's giant robots. And one of the robots is like the school bully. And
that accurately describes my junior high experience. Go on.
Yeah. So like the kids are all there, all the adults are like teachers and counselors and stuff. It's really cute. They do that stuff every once in a while.
All right, and I think that will actually do it for this first part. We're going to take a little bit of a break, because right now it's the Splatoon 2 test fire this hour, so we need to get some Splatoon 2 in, right, guys?
Yeah. You know, for sure. It.
You guys have fun with that. I'm going to be over here reading the outfit.
And we'll be back in like 10 seconds for you. And we're back. All right, so we ended up taking a lot more time than we originally intended on that little break.
Stop it.
Because hey, we were playing some Splatoon 2.
Some of us were playing Splatoon. Stop it.
It's never going to stop.
What is
it? It's not important what it is.
It's Navi.
Hey, hey, hey. Help.
So it's picking up through the mic, so like I'm getting a lot clearer. When you're not listening to it for like 60 hours, it's kind of the cutest thing ever.
That's what Miyamoto thought.
I had, hey, listen. Well, no, not for a long time. I had Zelda in general ringtones and for my text message sound. I had, hey, listen, for maybe about a day. And then just changed it to da-da-da-da.
Does someone want to call me? Just anybody. Call my number really quickly.
Oh, then we get to call me because it's shiny from Moana.
Which is great.
Yeah, I haven't seen that one yet.
Oh,
man, I should have mentioned that. I've probably seen Moana, 100 times now?
Oh, man.
That's what happens when you have kids.
It's replaced Inside Out in my house.
Steven hasn't seen one of the best movies, 2016.
What? What? Are we surprised by this? You listened to the 2016 episode.
Nice. Yeah, my ringtone is Breath of the Wild.
I love that music. I'm so glad I get to hear it in the game all the time.
Oh, yeah. About that. Anyway, so before we get into Breath of the Wild, which I know that... Really, Chris, Aldo, and I are all kind of chomping at the bit to just talk about this game because it's wonderful. But before we get into that, I want to talk a little bit about our history. Like, how it is that we actually got into Zelda, you know, have we ever really gotten into Zelda, etc. So let's start off with John.
Dang it, I had something.
We killed John. It did not take long.
The first Nintendo that I had besides a Game Boy was the 64, so Ocarina of Time was my first one. Ooh. Ocarina of Time, Ocarina. I say Ocarina of Time. I don't care. Whatever. Ocarina?
Like the French.
Acapulco of Time. don't reward that. That wasn't funny.
So Avocado of Time was my first one. And I mean, just based on the little that I've seen of Breath of the Wild, it seems like they have a lot in common. It's kind of like, you know, built on that. I don't know about this whole timeline thing. I don't think we need it, but
no. Let's not get into that. We're not Hyrule historians.
That's what you think I am. PhD in Zelda.
It's like the Deku Tree actually is a fern. So, oh jeez,
you started that one.
I don't know.
So that was the first game that I played, and I really have only played Ocarina of Time, and you know the Smash Brothers, and then watched 4 hours of Breath of the Wild went over to Chris's house. So I was just, wow. Do you want to try this out? No, I'm good. It was like watching a Miyazaki cartoon where the main character gets beat up a lot and falls off stuff.
And dies. It's a very beautiful game.
No, it's so sad because you like die and then it's like game over. And it's like, no, wait, isn't there like supposed to be a, do you want to continue? There's a fairy in the bottle that's going to save your life. It was just like dead, done, moving on. So, I guess, do we want to talk about our favorites? We're going to talk about favorite dungeons and characters
We'll talk about all that.
Yeah, all I know is Ocarina of Time. All I know is Zelda-related memes. All I know is that it's dangerous to go alone, and you should take the sword. And that is all.
But what he doesn't know is what love is.
Moving on! Chris, tell me about your
second
history
thing
with
that
Zelda.
Aldo said that made me giggle.
I had an NES growing up. Actually, my claim to fame is that I came out on the same day that the Nintendo came out in the US. So, it came out on my birthday, which is very exciting. But I actually never owned the original Legend of Zelda. And so I'm sure I rented it or played it at friends' houses, but like, my memories of the original Legend of Zelda are like the first three or four screens where you would die immediately the first 50 times you played it. And so that wasn't really it. My really big first Zelda experience was with A Link to the Past, which is maybe still my favorite Zelda game. I don't really have like, I can't really look at that objectively right now while I'm in the throes of Breath of the Wild. But it's just a fantastic game. I've beat it any number of times. Of my best favorite gaming moments, I think getting smelting the sword in that game and like
with the dwarves.
And like getting the Master Sword for the first time, and it's a masterful game. And the way that it handles the dark world and the way you like get turned into a bunny the first time. And like earlier in the game, like up on Death Mountain, you're like, what on earth just happened? And that's like, oh yeah, you're gonna spend like the remaining 65% of the game here. It's so good. It's just such a great game. And then obviously for our generation, I played Ocarina of Time. I have very fond memories of, you know, shooting birds and bats with ice arrows and watching them fall into Lake Hylia and going fishing. And yeah, you know, shooting targets on horseback and things like that. And then after that, I didn't really play any Zelda games until recently. I borrowed a friend's Wii U. I played through the original Legend of Zelda for the first time. I cheated hardcore because I knew I only had about a week and a half to play through. So I read guides. I did save and restore like on every room of every dungeon. So I beat that. And then I almost beat Wind Waker right before the Switch came out.
So Wind Waker HD is wonderful.
Yeah, I've got two dungeons left. I really liked it. I really tried to speed through it because I just didn't have time. But man, when you first get the King of Red Lions and end up on the open ocean, it's just like, it's a magical, magical moment. So yeah, that's my overly long history of Legend of Zelda.
Very nice.
Meanwhile, John. That's like it. It's just John with his phone and his little Zelda sounds.
Do what you're supposed to do.
Part of John will be played by John's iPhone.
All right, Aldo.
I was trying to give Alto an intro.
Alto?
Alto. I said Aldo, but I'm
Alto familiar.
Aldo the Alto.
I wish I could sing Alto. Anyways, no, so my history with Legend of Zelda starts with Majora's Mask, actually. That was the first.
Really?
Yeah, that was nice. The first game I picked up. I dropped it about probably one dungeon in. And then played... The ones that really hooked me was actually the Oracle of Ages and Seasons.
Oh, yeah!
Wow, those are good.
I hadn't really liked it all that much, and one of my friends picked up Oracle of Ages and let me borrow Seasons while he was playing through it, and he kind of got hooked on it, so... You know, we swapped, traded the codes and all that stuff. So it was a really cool first experience for that. Went back and played Majora's Mask, and then essentially played backwards from there. Went and then played Ocarina. Played A Link to the Past. Don't like Link to the Past all that much, which I know is kind of blasphemous.
How dare you!
Like you can't be a Zelda fan and not like it, because apparently it's sacrilege. But then after that, played Zelda 2 and then Zelda 1 and then pretty much played everything else.
You played everything in like the most strangest order. It's like pick your top most disappointing Zelda games for fans.
But yeah, so then played everything else after that as it was coming out, and kind of I've loved Zelda since. So that's kind of the thing. I mean, I have like. Obviously, you can't tell because it's an audio podcast. But I brought the Hyrule Historian, the Art and Artifacts, here for the podcast so that people could see it and vote if they wanted to.
If you hear a faint, in the background, that's what that is. It's the Temple of Time. It's just,
so beautiful.
But like, I mean, on top of that, I also own
the... You probably find that, actually.
The manga comics for each of the games that came out. By Akira Hibakawa. I have... I wish I had the originals, but I had the reprint they did of the comic from A Link to the Past.
I've never heard of these, so I'm suddenly
Yeah, you need these.
I'm going to bring because I thought everybody would...
Are they in English?
Yes.
What?
So they have like the little manga ones, which are, you know, black and white. Little, mm-hmm. Some of them are two volumes. I think Ocarina of Time is two volumes.
Yep.
There's another one, two volumes, I think.
I don't remember which one it is.
But I'll look it up later. So there's that, and then they did... It came out in Nintendo Power. It came out in Chapters.
Oh, okay.
It was A Link to the Past comic book, also by a pretty well-known manga artist at the time. He's kind of faded out by now. But it just retells the story. It's really well done. Beautiful artwork. And so a couple years ago, Dark Horse and Nintendo have been partnering up to... release all these, so they did those.
Oh my gosh, these comics are so good.
No, wait, it was Viz Media. It wasn't...
Yeah, it's Viz.
Viz did that. They also did one for the Super Mario Brothers comics that were at the...
Yes, which are also great.
Okay. Yes. So you can find them like on Amazon, though. It's like $15 full price, so you'll probably get it for cheaper on Amazon.
Nice.
Yep.
So I've been really big into like not just the games, but also the lore of Zelda. So it's one of those things that I just absolutely love the franchise. faults and all.
Yeah.
And it's had its missteps. A lot of them. But yeah.
The Complete Legend of Zelda manga anime book set for $50.
Yeah, you can get the nice. Whole dang thing.
And they're still coming out with not more. What I thought
of. With each out. Of the new games.
Wow.
Yeah, so I think they're behind... Oh, I think Twilight Princess is the other one that has two volumes.
That sounds right.
But I think they're barely coming out with the Skyward Sword one, and then in a few years they'll come out with the one for Breath of the Wild.
Yep.
And those are really cool. The art's beautiful. It's actually... It's under the title of one guy. It's named Akira Himekawa. But it's just a pen name for a team of two people.
Huh.
And I think that's the only thing they release under that pen name.
Like how Nine Inch Nails is just one dude.
Right, exactly.
Oh, wait, you're telling me it's not actual 9 1 Inch Nails playing music?
Oh, I was please. Surprised, Yikes. Too.
But yeah, that's it.
Very nice. Steven.
Well, posers.
That was much shorter than I thought.
So.
That's what you call anticipation.
I have played... Zelda.
It's just one note. You stop suck. It. I'm trying to talk about Zelda. I'm trying to give you some atmosphere to talk about Zelda.
I create Mickey. My own atmosphere.
Not in here. There's not a good ventilation.
So, Zelda. I have been playing Zelda for almost as long as I can remember. My brothers and I, we had a Nintendo. We had Zelda 1. We had Zelda 2. I've beaten Zelda 2. Which, it's hard. That last temple. I was actually replaying Zelda 2 not too long ago and realizing this is actually a really fun game. And then I started getting close to the end and I'm like, there's the last level that's coming. I don't want to do that. I haven't picked it up since. But I've beaten Zelda 2. My family did not have a Super Nintendo growing up, so I never played Link to the Past. But my brother would always go to his friends' houses and play the Super Nintendo games, and they recorded the soundtrack onto cassette tapes. So I listened to the soundtrack for Link to the Past over and over and over again.
Wow.
Loved it as a kid.
Wait, have you played it? Have you gone back and...
I have still never gone back and played it because I skipped the whole Super Nintendo generation. But I had a Game Boy, and I played Link's Awakening, which is amazing.
Underrated.
Potentially the most underrated Zelda game. Ocarina of Time completely changed my life. Like, I have very vivid memories of the first time I was watching that game, and there's a cutscene of Ganon riding his horse, galloping across the land, and there was, like, flames? Because I'd skipped a generation... Going from the Nintendo to the N64, that completely blew my mind. And it was that game that did it. I bought a Nintendo 3DS after years and years and years of not owning a Nintendo console because I wanted to play Zelda, darn it.
I could have had that Ganon galloping up in the flames music ready if you'd given me a heads up.
This is a really nice moment. This is an off-the-cuff podcast. Come on. When I was really young, my brothers and I, you go back and you like, play act your favorite stories with your brothers and stuff. We play acted Zelda, and in our version of the story, Zelda and Link got married and had a son named Abel. So the legend continued.
Yeah.
I remember the Super Nintendo or the Nintendo Power comic, which completely shaped my opinion of Zelda in a completely different way, because that comic has sort of this bittersweet ending, and I have always associated Zelda with this sort of bittersweet atmosphere ever since. And even though you've got all the comedy, you've got all of the adventure and the excitement, there is kind of this underlying sadness. It's almost like a Lancelot and Guinevere sort of thing. Like, Link and Zelda, I don't know. Their relationship seems somewhat ill-fated to me. It always has.
You know, except I've never really felt of it like that way. I've always felt like they're just kind of individual, like, people... I know everybody likes the thing that they get together. Like, that's kind of the goal.
Because he's the hero, she's the princess.
Right, yeah.
What are we supposed to think?
I never felt it was that way. I always felt like they were, like, the people who were doing, like, their duty. And, like, once that was done, they would, you know, go off to their separate ways.
And there's something that's kind of sad about that.
Yeah, I will say on that note, I think Breath of the Wild will not disappoint you.
Oh, like, so excited about this. So yeah, like Zelda has been a big part of my life my whole life. The only times I haven't played Zelda are the times in my life when I haven't been playing video games. And I've been going back and I've been picking up some of the games that I've missed. I was not playing video games when Oracle of Ages and Oracle of Seasons came out. Mm. So I have started playing those. I wasn't really playing video games around the time of Majora's Mask. After Ocarina of Time, I kind of dropped off video games for a while. I've gone back and played that one most of the way through because I don't finish video games anymore, and it's been great.
It's been great not finishing video games?
Yes. Okay. Yes, it has.
That's another underrated one, I feel like, Majora's Mask. Like, when we had one friend that had it growing up, and it was like, why? Like, this game looks weird. I never want to play it.
We're going to talk about it. Don't you worry. We're going to talk about it.
Say something about that. I always have to go on my hipster.
Maybe we're not going to talk about it. Ocarina of Time is my favorite Zelda game. Or not Ocarina of Time, excuse me. Majora's Mask is my favorite Zelda game, followed closely by Link's Awakening for the Game Boy. Those are my two favorites.
Wow.
Because with all the going back and forth in time, it feels like the whole game is just the water level from Ocarina of Time. Am I wrong to assume that?
Majora's Mask, you mean?
Yeah.
Majora's Mask, you want to talk about a Zelda game with a bittersweet ending? It's freaking Majora's Mask.
No. There's not even anything sweet about it.
Well, I mean, people don't die. That's pretty great.
Except everybody's already dead to begin with.
Yeah. Oh, jeez. So one of the great things about Majora's Mask is, like, Link saves the world and nobody knows about it or cares. And it's just, like, so sad. I love it. The whole game is really sad. And then you've got Link's Awakening. Spoiler alert, from the title of the game, though, this isn't a spoiler. Link is asleep the whole time. The whole thing is a dream.
Huh.
But these characters have fully fleshed out lives. There's a character who's sort of an XP of Princess Zelda, and she's someone that you talk to a lot. There's this really touching scene where you sit down at the side of a beach and you're talking to her. Well, she's talking to you because you're Link and you don't say anything. Yeah. And she's, like, telling you all her thoughts and her hopes and, like, I want to get off this island someday. And when you wake up, she doesn't exist anymore. It's super heavy.
About that. He's like, my dreams have gotten really intense, and this girl in his dream is like, don't wake up, I don't want to die. It's really messed up.
So I've been somewhat disappointed with the direction Zelda games have taken recently. I played Link Between Worlds, and I kind of think the game is not very good. So I've been watching my roommate play Breath of the Wild. I'm not coming into this without having any experience with the game. I would sit there. I'm like the girlfriend in the relationship that's like, why don't you try this? I'm telling him how to do the puzzles. And I'm just enjoying that experience so much. So much. Like, this game has me very, very excited. I will be buying a Switch just to play this one game.
I've told my wife, like, multiple times, you know, if something were to just happen to Nintendo, some sort of otherworldly event where Nintendo just ceased to exist tomorrow, I would not be disappointed with my Switch purchase. If it were only a Zelda machine forever, it would be worth the money. I'd be in.
Okay. Yeah,
keep that attitude, because on Black Friday, we're going to play the convince my wife to get this.
We'll start that up.
Are you going to wait till Black Friday?
I really can't just... Even then, I'm getting plenty of enjoyment out of my Xbox 360 and my original Wii. I haven't beaten Mario Galaxy yet.
There's a second one, right?
Yeah!
I just found that out!
Yeah!
So good.
So yeah, that's my Zelda experience.
Very nice. So... I don't know if you guys know this, but I'm a pretty big fan of Zelda.
He is wearing a Zelda hat, Zelda shirt, and what I can imagine is Zelda long underwear under his jeans.
Well, and not only that, but I'll pass around my wedding ring, and you will notice...
Your wedding ring.
My actual freaking wedding ring.
Okay, I recognize the ring, but I didn't realize this was your wedding ring.
Has the Triforce and the Hylian crest on it.
Oh my gosh.
It's pretty wonderful.
Yeah, that's pretty dope.
Yep, my wife knows me.
The patience of a saint she has.
So Zelda has always been a huge, huge, huge part of my life. I remember trying the first game and dying miserably and not understanding it because I was way too young to really understand what's going on there. And then I remember Zelda 2 and just hating the horse head guys. I remember that from my childhood. But it was...
You're talking about the boss of the first temple, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, that guy's great.
Oh, man. And then after that, Link to the Past is really what brought me into games, just in general. Just that game drew me in so much that it formed a lot of who I became later on in life. And just everything about it. Like Chris was saying, there are so many little moments that I will always remember. The first time that you go into the dark world and you're a bunny.
Man.
And I'm just like, what's going on? Why am I? What?
And it's not like there were trailers in those days. So you're like, oh, this is that dark world part everyone's been talking about. Like, it just happened in a vacuum and it's just crazy.
There were trailers, but they were just Link breakdancing.
Oh my gosh, those are so great. Those are so great, you guys.
Or it was like the two nerds on the on the couch, and they're like, look at these graphics, they're so realistic, and it's like an 8-bit Octorok.
Oh man, good times. And then Ocarina of Time came out and blew my mind, and for a long time that was my favorite game, period, and I didn't think that it would ever be topped. Metroid Prime did that, but
not GoldenEye?
Nope.
Or is it apples and oranges?
Yeah, they're completely separate experiences. But, you know, even still with Metroid Prime, Zelda was still my favorite series. I loved Majora's Mask, loved Wind Waker. Twilight Princess was pretty good. And Skyward Sword, meh. And then, you know the mobile games, I loved pretty much all of them. For just how different they were. Like, I even love the DS ones that a lot of people aren't really into. Phantom Hourglass and Spirit Tracks, I love them. I think that they have some really interesting puzzles and some weird design choices that they wouldn't have been able to get away with on a full console game.
As much as I've kind of, like, poo-pooed the handheld Zelda games, the one area where they absolutely do not fall down is in the dungeon design, mm-hmm. I think. I've really enjoyed the dungeons.
Minish Cap has some of the best 2D dungeons,
I think. Minish Cap is great.
So does, 3D dungeons. You want to talk about, you know, the 3DS. As much as I don't like Link Between Worlds, some of those dungeons are pretty rad. Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, since then, you know, since Skyward Sword, you know, my love for the Zelda franchise had kind of been wavering for a while until, you know, Breath of the Wild. And now I can't stop thinking about it. Right now, I'm so tempted to stop talking, even though I'm in the middle of a podcast, grab my Switch, and keep playing, because I am that obsessed with it. And, you know, we'll get into Breath of the Wild a little bit later on.
Brady, the first step is admitting that you have a problem.
But anyway, before we get into the Breath of the Wild talk, I do want to talk about some of the staples of the Zelda franchise.
Lighting one torch in front of a locked door and then lighting the other unlit torch in front of the locked door.
That's just a thing you do.
Pushing blocks into blazes. Before we get into that, you know, Stephen, you mentioned that one of the great things about the mobile game specifically are the dungeons. And I want to talk about dungeons for a minute here, because that is one thing that has been consistent with every Zelda, is you have these crazy dungeons that are just full of so many puzzles and interesting combat and, you know, have a satisfying boss at the end. So I wanted to just, you know, open this up to you guys. What is your favorite Zelda dungeon?
Such a hard question, honestly.
I have one.
go right ahead, Aldo.
It's the desert dungeon from Majora's Mask.
That's a good one.
It's really cool in that you play it, you're kind of keeping an eye on things. You're getting used to the layout, then halfway through the dungeon, you have to flip the whole thing upside down.
Freaking got so stuck on this dungeon.
And my mind was like, what? and then after that, you put on a giant's mask, and then you had to go in a kaiju fight with Link and a giant sandworm.
You can win that fight without the giant's mask.
You can, but why would you?
Fair.
But that's honestly been one of my favorite dungeons. Nothing ever really sticks out to me, at least not since Breath of the Wild, though I can't really call them dungeons, and they're not nearly as complex as like dungeons in the past. But I think one of my favorite ones has been, at least in Breath of the Wild, it's probably my number two, is the one that happens in the volcano.
Oh, that's a good one.
And not even because it's complicated. The boss fight is not satisfying or all that hard. But the fact that, like, for the first time, I think, in a Zelda game, you can really, like, walk out of the dungeon, but still be in the dungeon. So you see this giant thing walking around the volcano. You can make it turn and it'll walk up the side of the volcano. And you can see all of this happening from outside of it. I was like, this is that thing that happened to me when I saw the whole temple flip upside down. Like, that was that kind of same feeling. But that one in Majora's Mask was probably... It's probably still my favorite dungeon in a Zelda game.
Oh, it's so good.
So, just offhand, I think it's from Link's Awakening, the Game Boy game. I think it's Eagle's Tower that stands out the most in my mind. It's a dungeon which... You know, we're talking Game Boy, so we're talking an old game. It's a dungeon that you actually need to kind of start thinking in three dimensions, because in order to succeed, in order to get through the dungeon, you actually have to wipe out a whole floor and collapse the tower down.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. It that's something that happens a lot more in some of the later Zelda games. I want to say that, I know Majora's Mask actually has a similar dungeon.
I mean, a lot of the water temples in 3D kind of take that approach where you have to, like,
Water temple.
Yeah. But this one, I remember one thing in particular that I remember about the Game Boy Link's Awakening is that you go into the dungeons and in certain areas, you'll run into other Mario enemies or other Nintendo enemies.
Chain chomps.
Yeah, there are chain chomps. There's a chain chomp that you got to take on a walk in the game. But in the dungeons, you fight Goombas and Piranha Plants. You can hop on Goombas. There is a Kirby monster eats you like Kirby does. These games were so fun. But yeah, it was that dungeon in particular, Eagle's Tower, where you have to knock part of the tower down so to access other parts of the level that you couldn't get to before.
It was a part of history where you could have Easter eggs and not have a bunch of fanboys start theorizing whether or not these games take place in the same universe or not. Simpler times.
Yes. Thanks, YouTube.
The other dungeon that I want to call out specifically, and this maybe isn't going to mean as much to those of you who didn't like or haven't played the very first Zelda game, but Death Mountain from the original Zelda game was quite the achievement, I gotta say. Because this was a time, again, we're talking pre-internet, there were tip lines, there was Nintendo Power, so there were ways of finding things out, but in order for us, me and my brothers, we didn't have a lot of those. In order for us to beat that, we had graph paper, and we were drawing maps. And Death Mountain in the first Zelda game is really, really hard to navigate. You think about, like, we were talking briefly at some point tonight about Super Mario Brothers, the original game. And if you ever got to World 8-2, the final Bowser castle, it's a maze. It's really hard to get through. And again, they weren't always very secure in their playability. Sometimes, like, they just designed things because they were difficult, but not necessarily because they'd be fun. Mm-hmm. I kind of think that Death Mountain wound up like this, except part of the fun of Zelda is the difficulty. Yeah. So, and that's where you fight the craziest monsters, like the eyeballs that have other eyeballs that fly around them, and rooms.
Well, and you have to replay a bunch of the bosses, which became kind of a staple in later Zelda games.
A few of them, yeah. I think the dragon was in there, one that has like four heads.
He's like way harder. I think he was in there. Oh, the first time.
Oh, geez, yeah. Those are the two dungeons I think that stand out the most for me from the entire Zelda series.
Cool. I like the Forest Temple.
Oh, the Forest Temple.
Yes, please.
Kind of hunting down the Poes.
My gosh, I forgot about the Poes.
Well, getting there.
That's the best.
And getting there, the first time, you have to get past all the giants. And so you're like, wow, I'm an adult now. I have a sword. And oh, that giant just impaled me. I died. And you're like, okay, I'm not going to make that mistake again. Oh, there's more of them. And, you know, you finally get in there. You have to get the hook shot and everything. And then it's an interesting temple. I like the music, too. It's kind of this, like, haunting echo weird, you know.
Yeah.
Going on. But I, without all the experience of all the other Zeldas, I was limited to Ocarina of Time. And I really like that one because the other ones, I hate the Water Temple. Hate the Water Temple. Like, the last time I played through it, I did it, like, perfect. Like, changed the levels in the right order and didn't miss anything, and I still hated it.
Yeah.
That's the best boss, though, because it's easy once you get there. But hated the water temple. Anyway.
So there are two separate temples in Twilight Princess that I absolutely love. One of them is the Snowpeak Ruins.
Oh, the mansion, right?
Yeah, which takes place basically in a mansion instead of like a castle.
It's
or
a Yeti's mansion. It's the cutest.
It's and just because it's so creative, because you're like, I'm in a house. This isn't some ancient temple. It's a house.
And it feels like a house, too. Like, that's the best thing, too.
Oh, yeah.
It never feels like, I'm in a dungeon that's shaped like a house. It feels like, I'm in a mansion.
And the other one that I loved was Arbiter's Grounds, which is, it's the deserty temple with the spinner.
Yeah, okay.
And so you get this item, you know, and one of the staples of Zelda is you get items in temples and then you use it in that temple, and usually those items are very useful outside of the temple. The spinner, not really. But so basically it's like you're riding on a top throughout the level.
You're
and it's just
through Zelda.
Yeah, exactly. that is pretty much the perfect explanation. It's like you're Beyblading through Zelda. You're going and you're bouncing off of the walls, and just that mechanic made that temple so much fun.
Oh, that's cool, man. There's so many games I have to go back and play. Like, I love that you called Twilight Princess like kind of disappointing, and then you're like, but it has these amazing temples. I'm like, dang it, we have to check it out.
Is that the one where he turns into a wolf? Right?
Yes.
Yeah. Twilight Princess just felt like, hey, you kids that like Ocarina of Time, you know how you want that gritty Zelda? Here you go.
Now, you know how you complain like, about Wind Waker?
You know how you like innovation or storytelling?
But wait, I do like those things. Nope.
It's even the get off my back of Zelda games.
I do love Midna. I think that Midna is a great character, and that game is worth it just for her.
I went to Salt Lake Comic Con. First time there, I saw a guy dressed up as Midna, and like he was wearing a kilt. And I'm like, can I get a picture with you? And he's like, okay. And in the picture, I'm like on all fours, and he is riding me as if I were Wolf Link. And it is one of the most amazing and awkward things that has ever happened to me.
That is awesome.
I just usually take pictures of people in cosplay. Like, Steven inserts himself into the story. And so, like... You know, Korra from Legend of Korra was like waterbending at him in his last photo session.
Yeah.
Oh, it was a cool picture.
I got a picture with a guy who was dressed up as the Crow.
Yikes.
From the movie. And I'm like, hey, why don't you like hit me in the face as part of this picture? He's like, okay. And he like grabs my arm, puts it in a lock, and actually punches me. It was the best thing. Man.
I think he took a picture with my friend.
Yeah. You know, Aldo knows the Crow.
I have a friend who does a very excellent Crow cosplay, but that's neither here nor there.
So, back to Zelda dungeons.
Zelda dungeons?
My favorite Zelda dungeon is actually Fan-X.
Can never find the boss key in that place.
Side quest where you have to find a bathroom, but it doesn't. Reek.
try. I went with my 9-month-old. Try finding a men's room with a changing table that's not covered in pee.
Like I said, my favorite Zelda game is probably A Link to the Past. I love it, and I'd have a hard time picking like a single dungeon. Although, oh man, I don't know. Those first three are so good. One of the ones I love the most is Blind's Hideout.
Yes.
Just because
I was going to talk about this.
It's like it's such a weird story thing that there's like this gang of thieves that you have to infiltrate, and they're all kind of like weird '90s bros, and like actually named my
with those eyebrows. Those big eyebrows on
and,
the sprites.
Like, I named my Nintendo ID when I got my Switch, I named it Yo Link, because I like the guy that's like, Yo Link, I heard that there used to be a thief that lived here. And, like, it's just such a weird, like, I don't know, obscure Zelda thing. Like, when Zelda first started getting really whimsical. But the other one that I kind of feel like deserves a shout out is that I love the approach to dungeons that Breath of the Wild takes. If I were to think of what are the things that I hate the most about dungeons? Like the water temple. It's like, I love the individual puzzles. I love the idea that like you walk into this room and it's like, okay, I have to figure out how to solve this room and then I can get to the next room. And what I hate about Zelda dungeons is when you've solved everything and then you just can't figure out how to get from point A to point B sometimes, or you have to do this giant...
How am I like, missing a key? Where the crap is a key?
Oh my gosh, it's like, oh, I missed a treasure chest, and I have to backtrack through the whole thing. Like, most of the Wind Waker dungeons, I feel like, really hit me with that. And Breath of the Wild just takes... They look at, okay, what's great about dungeons? Well, what if we just pull all of those individual parts out, make 120 of them, spread them across the world, and let you solve them at your leisure?
All the shrines are so wonderful. We'll be getting into that
a little bit more. Oh my gosh. I just, like... I love the idea that there are just so many of these little puzzles that are just one and done. It's a portable device. I can be like, oh, you know, I'm good. Sometimes I'll find a bunch of shrines and save them up and then later like go through them when I'm when I just have a few minutes to play. And then the Divine Beasts. The Divine Beasts are so excellent. I've only done two of them.
They're mechs, right? So are they mechs?
They're like Power Rangers Zords.
Yes! Yes!
Yeah.
And you basically have to... There's some sort of lead up to where you more or less fight them before you enter them.
Cool.
Oh, yeah, the lead up to that's...
The lead up is...
My biggest disappointment is that you can't replay that.
Oh yeah,
because those for me, my favorite part of the Divine Beast has been that. I mean, we can talk about it.
Oh yeah, we'll talk more about Breath of the Wild a little bit later. But you know, before we get into Breath of the Wild talk, I do want to talk about, and I'm actually going to go ahead and combine these favorite bosses and favorite items.
Okay. So favorite boss, I've got to say, I think the boss's name is actually Goat. From Majora's Mask.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Like even before I had really come to appreciate the bittersweet tone of Majora's Mask, I would go back and I would play this boss over and over again. So there are only four real dungeons in Majora's Mask. The boss of the second dungeon, one of the quirks of Majora's Mask, just so people who maybe haven't played the game know, is you actually get these masks that are the spirits of these fallen warriors, and you become these warriors. So in the Snow Temple, you play as a Goron, because you have the Goron's mask. Mm. And the boss is this giant goat. He's a giant monster, like, on four legs that just runs around in a circle. And that's all he does, is runs around in a circle. And you are not fast enough to get in touch, like, to get close to him and hit him, unless you're wearing the Goron costume or the Goron mask, because then you can roll up into a ball and spin like a tire. And so you are racing this goat around the track, and you turn into, like, you get spikes all around your body, and you, like, slam into the goat and knock him down, and then you gotta, like, go up and slash him like you normally do. And it's just so high-paced and so... It's easy. It's one of the easiest boss fights, but it's so fun and it's so novel.
It feels intense too.
It feels really intense.
Part of the thing is, so you have to have magic power in order to activate your spikes, and there's like these little like pots scattered throughout the field that you have to hit them and recharge, or else you're just kind of stuck.
And then you will get run over.
So even though it's like, especially if you know what you're doing or like what to do, it's actually really easy.
Oh yeah.
But that first time you play it, you're just like, oh my gosh, this is Fast and the Furious Zelda Edition.
It really is like they weaponized Mario Kart. It's so great. Easily my favorite boss in the entire Zelda franchise.
I think, what are your favorite item?
Did you say? I haven't said a favorite item. I kind of have to think about that one.
Okay. So I guess I'll just go for the boss in the meantime. So one of my favorite bosses, actually, because for some reason, we keep just hating on Twilight Princess.
And that's the thing, like, Twilight Princess has some great dungeons, and it has some great bosses.
Everything else in it is just kind of mediocre. Anyways, but... my favorite boss fight is actually the final Zant fight.
Oh, that's so good.
And I mean, if you want to include it, also like the fight with Ganon right after that is actually a perfect cap to that fight. But the fight with Zant, who is, they call him, what, the Twilight Usurper or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And he's pretty much like a greatest hits of all the dungeons and bosses that you've done, because he teleports you to all the dungeons, all the dungeon boss fights you've gone, and he essentially takes the place of each of those kind of bosses. So you have to, like, remember how you beat each dungeon and boss, and beat him, and then you kind of, you fight him individually in a sword fight. And then after that, you had to fight Ganondorf in a sword fight as well, but Ganondorf is massive. So Zant is also just kind of a little shorter than Link. He has this mask, which makes him look a little taller. But you're fighting essentially somebody who's almost on a level playing field. He pulls out, like, two swords out of his, like, big old sleeves. And, like, does a spinning top attack. And it's a little over the top. Zant is a crazy character. He's over the top. He's a little unstable, but he's just kind of a fun villain. Which is contrasted really well by Ganondorf, because this is, like, the most serious version we've seen is in Twilight Princess. And he's just a mountain of a man carrying a giant sword that was used to stab him and imprison him into, like, another dimension. And he's just using that. And so you, if you go up to him, he would just kick you back. Like, he wouldn't even, like, stab you or hit you. He would just kick you back with his foot. And you're like, oh, okay, crap. But I remember that fight just actually being, like, the perfect cap to that game. Because there were several times in the game where I was just like, I don't want to finish this. And when I got to that, I was like, okay, this was worth it. This kind of, this was worth price of admission, was the big boss fight at the end of Twilight Princess.
So that's a good one.
So, if we're doing favorite items too, I'm going to throw my favorite item into the ring right now. It's an item that exists in only the Game Boy game, and it does something that no other item in any... No, but that's a good one. No other item in any Zelda game has ever allowed Link to do. In the Game Boy game, Link's Awakening, you can get a rock's feather, which lets you jump at will.
Until Breath of the Wild.
Until Breath of the Wild, fair enough. But yeah, like, having the ability to actually press B to jump or press A to jump, because you can assign it to either slot, in a Zelda game.
I was just thinking about that. I was like, he jumps all the time in Ocarina? No.
Only when there's a ledge.
Only when, like, there's a ledge.
There's a ledge, you can jump if you run up to the ledge at the right angle. But with the rock's feather, you can jump whenever you want. It's pretty great. Anyway, yeah, I just like the novelty of actually having a Link who can jump.
I think for me, my favorite item is... It's the masks. I don't want to, like, call out a specific mask, but I think...
Just the Keaton mask. The Pikachu mask.
The Pikachu mask, yes.
I love the masks, like, in general from Majora's Mask. They were in Ocarina time, but they were just kind of a little novelty side quest. So for them to, like, kind of become the thing in Majora's Mask was kind of a great thing. And, you know, you had the Transforming Mask. You also had, like, just a bunch of other masks that did a variety of things. That is one that made your face into a bomb.
Yeah. And every time you blow up, you lose a heart, because
unless
you're a bomb.
Unless you're shielding for some reason.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. You know, there was a Keaton mask, one of my favorite masks. Actually, I guess if I'm going to pick one, it has to be the...
Fierce Deity?
No.
Yeah, that's pretty good, though.
The Lover's Mask.
Oh, my gosh.
It's useless. It does nothing except for helping you complete one of the greatest side quests in all of Zelda history.
I kind of wanted to bring this up when we were talking about dungeons, because my favorite thing about Majora's Mask is not the dungeons, it's the bomber's notebook.
Yeah.
It's this little tool that lets you, like, find out what's going on other people's lives, and it keeps track of these quests so you can do things to make them just a little bit happier because their lives are so miserable. And the quest that Aldo was talking about is demonstrably the best.
It's also one of the ones that, like, it takes you the span of all 3 days. It's an amazing story. It's like this whole end of the world thing. You have to help reunite these two lovers. One who's been cursed to look like a child. So he wears a mask so he can't be recognized. But you know, and you know about his wife. So you have to, like, or his fiance. So you have to, like, help them reconnect over the span of 3 days. And then take a picture of them right before the world ends, essentially. And it's happening all the way up until the final minute. So you're trying to take a photo of them as the entire Earth is, like, rumbling and shaking under, like, the weight of the moon that's about to crush everybody. And it's intense.
It's a wonderful, wonderful moment.
It sold me on Majora's Mask. I have not cared until now. It just seemed like it would be tedious and hard.
It is.
But there are these moments like this that make it so worth it. Also, you get to save cows from an alien invasion.
Yeah.
Also, can I just suggest play the 3DS version?
Yes, absolutely. The 3DS version is. Maybe not the definitive version, but it's certainly the best version.
Yeah, and well, and especially like the way that they do the Bomber's Notebook in there is so much cleaner, better than the original N64 version.
This is all true.
So cool. for bosses, there's one boss that I absolutely love from Wind Waker, and I think this is the first boss, and that's Goma, which is this giant millipede thing coming out of lava. And what I love about it is the way that you defeat it is you're on this place called Dragon Roost Island. And it's called Dragon Roost Island because this ancient dragon is just sitting on top of it. And on top of this volcano. And his tail is coming down through the ceiling. And the way that you beat this boss is you actually have to use your hookshot, which in this game is a rope with a hook on it. Hmm. And you have to hook the dragon's tail and basically swing on it to pull it so that the top of the mountain basically falls down on this boss. And it's just, it's so much fun and it's so satisfying. And I love it. I just love Wind Waker. I love all these games. What can I say?
I spent a good portion of that just like running around in circles in the room. Like, how on earth do I do this? And then just happened to look up and was like, okay, all right.
I feel like that happens a lot where it's like, I'm dying, I'm dying, I'm dying. There's nothing that makes any sense. Oh.
I did the exact same thing in Breath of the Wild.
Yeah, that's Breath of the Wild to a T. But, and then items. I love the double claw shots from Twilight Princess. Because, you know, hookshots have always been a part of Zelda, you know. And the thing about the double claw shots is basically you have two hookshots. So you can hookshot into one thing, and then while you're hanging there, you can hookshot into another thing. So it kind of makes you a very slow-moving Spider-Man.
Nice.
But it's a lot of fun to use.
It's Spider-Man if you have absolutely no cares in the world and no hurry to get anywhere.
Pretty much. Also, I love the metal boots in Twilight Princess just because of the dungeon that you have where
with the
magnetic. Yes. It's so much fun because basically, like, you spend a lot of time walking around a ceiling shooting at different things with your bow and arrow while hanging upside down. It's pretty awesome.
Man, so many good bosses. I think one of my favorites is the boss from Death Mountain in A Link to the Past. Just because I love that it's a boss that doesn't really kill you instantly or like set you back or make you hide behind things. It's just a boss where if you get hit, you get bounced off of the platform
and you have to
go back up the stairs. Like, it's a great, like, it's just this weird, annoying thing, and having to kind of plan, you know, okay, I'm gonna charge my spin or I'm gonna hold my sword this way and try not to get hit while it's going in a kind of weird curlicue. I just think that's fun. And then favorite item, I gotta say the boomerang. I mean,
oh, classic,
you know,
absolutely classic.
Especially, I love it in Wind Waker, how you can target like five different things.
Yeah,
with the boomerang.
Yeah.
Or like in the DS game, so you could like draw out the path for it.
Oh, yeah, that's so nice.
Yeah. And
totally not real life, is it?
Who cares?
There you go.
That is what a boomerang sounds like.
It's excellent in the original Legend of Zelda. Like, I feel like it totally changes the game.
Yeah, if you have anything in your B slot, other than the boomerang, you are solving a puzzle.
Yep.
Or you're playing the game wrong.
Yeah. Agreed. Also, I played most of that game on the Wii U gamepad, which I did not realize has the worst D-pad known to man. And so, like, that game is really hard. And so I ended up really relying on the boomerang until I pulled out a Wiimote one day. I was like, oh, wow, this isn't impossible anymore. I actually have some amount of control. And then, I mean, I just have to give a shout out for how boomerangs are handled in Breath of the Wild, which is just
it's so satisfying.
It's so good.
So satisfying.
I still always equip, like, have two of them in my inventory just because boomerang. Come on. Yeah.
I threw a boomerang years ago. It hasn't come back. I live in constant fear.
So I also, you know, just talking about Link to the Past, I have to call out a couple bosses in Link to the Past that I absolutely love. One is the Helmsar King, which is
I haven't even played the game and I know what you're talking about.
It's like this scorpion frog thing with a mask on it, and you have to hammer the mask. You can either hammer the mask, or I didn't realize that you could hammer the mask, and I would actually bomb the mask.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
And in order to get to it, and that was so cool. And the other boss that I have to call out, just because it was so weird, and this is going back to Chris talking about dungeons, is Blink.
Yeah.
For the dungeon that Chris was talking about, where it's the basically infiltrating this group of thieves, you're guiding this little girl around for the entire dungeon and kind of like keeping her safe, and then you get her into this room and there's light shining in, and you keep on hearing about how the boss of these thieves, Blink, doesn't like light, and you end up bombing on another floor, so light shines through into this room, and then you take this little girl into the room into the light, and then she turns into the boss.
What?
It's pretty great.
It's a pretty awesome moment.
I like Morpha, who's the boss in the water temple, because it means you're done with the water
temple. Tell us how you really feel about the water temple.
I feel like the water temple should be full of, like, the what? It's worse than Hitler.
Oh, my God.
I wish I had a more clever answer for that. I really don't like it, because it's just, I just did that. And you get the compass, and you're like, oh, there's a, I'm in the room. I'm in the room where the treasure chest is. It's five floors up. And there's always, like, you have to just finagle your way to get back to where you can change the water level, and it's just a pain in the butt. And I really hate the little guys that live on the bottom, and they're, like, they're easy to kill, but they're always just kind of clanking around and annoying, and then the guys do the little, guys who can, like, skim on top of the water, you know, they're just kind of in the way, and, you know, they don't really present a threat as much as an annoyance, and every time you come in and out of a room, they respawn. It's I don't like it, guys.
I'd like to voice a contrarian opinion about the water temple.
Ooh, somebody's getting punched.
Yeah, no, I'm not an idiot. I just wanted to mess with John.
Go on.
No, the water temple is bad.
It's really bad. I thought you were going to say, actually, I think that it represents... And I wanted to ask, speaking of water temple, I wanted to ask about Dark Link in the games as a whole. Is that something that pops up everywhere?
Zelda most 2. Games? Zelda mm-hmm. 2 is where Dark Link initiates.
It pops up inconsistently. He's part of the plot of Twilight Princess.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, where he apparently, according to Hyrule Historia, represents the Link from the very first Zelda game, because apparently that Link didn't save the world, or no, he represents, like, Link from a timeline where Link didn't defeat Ganon, which is apparently one of the canon endings of... It's super weird. No, I've read up on this. This is weird.
No, I mean, they talk about how, like, the Triforce got split into three pieces, and they show three Dark Links, splitting the Triforce into three pieces.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's something different than what I was thinking.
Yeah.
Clearly.
Yeah. The end of Scott Pilgrim where he has to fight Dark Scott?
Yes.
He's like a pretty cool guy.
Yeah. In Zelda 2, Link's Adventure, when you're in that freaking terrible last dungeon, there's a room where you're walking along and there's, like, your shadow, and all of a sudden your shadow jumps out and you have to fight it. and it's a pain in the butt.
Because it jumps on your sword.
Yep. Well, yeah, there's that. That's actually kind of a cheesy way of beating it. But, yeah, he's a difficult fight.
Hang on. That whole explanation went over my head, but I can't find the Goron sound to explain how I'm feeling.
While we're voicing some complaints about the Zelda series, I have to voice the biggest complaint that I have and the reason, probably more than any other reason, why I'm not a fan of Link Between Worlds. And in order to do this, I'm going to have to spoil the ending.
Okay.
So, spoiling the ending of Link Between Worlds. So, the gimmick of Link Between Worlds is that there's this wizard that's come from, like, another dimension, and he's turning everybody into paintings, and he's trying to get the power of the Triforce. The reason that he's doing it is because he's actually from a parallel world to Hyrule called Lorule. Lorule does not have a Triforce, and so Lorule is falling apart. And so the princess of Lorule, whose name is Hilda...
Oh, jeez, come on.
Sends this evil wizard to get the Triforce from Hyrule. And at the end of the game, after you've beaten the evil wizard, Hilda comes out, the Lorule Princess Zelda, and she looks like she's about to mess you up. And I was about to get really excited because a fight with an evil Zelda would have been amazing. And that is not what happens.
Aww. You kind of get that in Twilight Princess.
Yeah, you kind of do, but it's Zelda possessed by Ganon, which isn't the same thing. Did we just spoil the end of Twilight Princess?
Yeah.
That's okay. Yeah, it's... Well, old game. Sorry, like, whatevs. Guys, you had your opportunity to play it unspoiled and you blew it. So, joke's on you.
And with that, I'd like to talk about the ending of Breath of the Wild.
No!
Just kidding, everybody. So,
I actually know. I'm just kidding. Why,
dude. So any other call-outs for items or bosses?
I still can't find the friggin' Goron sound.
Wait. What are the bombs called in Ocarina of Time? The
shoes? The bomb shoes.
Bomb shoes.
Oh, I love bombs.
Those are...
Sad they're not in Breath of the Wild.
They're so good.
They have no practical purpose. Those things are so useless.
There's got to be a way to make one, right? I mean, you've got a physics engine. You can probably figure it out.
Just a hill. Octoballoon on a ball that's a vertical.
Start blowing it away.
Wait, hold on. I think I found it.
Have you gone sailing in that?
No.
Oh, you can do that with a leaf and a boat and a sail. Just... Yeah,
wait, like, just like on a raft, you mean? Yeah. Like, oh, yep. Sure. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Have you guys tried doing the flying rafts?
I haven't yet.
Yeah, but I think...
Yeah, it's useless, but it's cool that you can do it.
That's not a Goron sound.
I've given up on the Goron sound.
I think, to me, the flying rafts are like the most just cause thing you can do in that game so far.
Somebody
oh, wait, here we go.
It's castle using a flying raft. It's amazing.
Oh, you're supposed to... These are so disappointing.
Hey, Brady, what's next on the agenda?
So,
Boom! Friggin' thing. We're gonna ruin Breath of the Wild, right?
Yeah, so we are about to talk about Breath of the Wild, and here's the thing about anytime that you talk about Breath of the Wild, you're going to have spoilers, because Breath of the Wild is all about exploration. It's all about finding things out and going on an adventure and being like, I had no idea that you could do that in this game. And so we'll try to keep it as spoiler-free as possible, but at the same time, I'm sorry. It's going to happen.
I wonder if we could lay, like, ground rules of things we won't spoil.
Okay.
Like, I'm guessing the ending, right?
Yeah, I think story in general past, you know, you wake up 100 years after something in the Shrine of Resurrection and you don't know what's going on and you don't know who you are.
Yeah, I think probably we wouldn't talk about specific divine beasts in too much detail that would, you know, spoil those memories, things like that. But other than that, it's just, yeah.
The Elder Scrolls, Hyrule. That's what I think it is.
Yeah.
Okay, so giant crabs.
So I think, I don't know if you had a...
So here's the thing about Zelda Breath of the Wild. So I was a little bit disappointed when I heard that last year for E3 that Nintendo was just Breath of the Wild, you know, which, you know, I was always very excited about this game, but at the same time, I'm like, oh, that's really all that you're bringing to
E3,
just one game, okay, whatever. And then I watched 10 hours of streaming
Treehouse video.
From, you know, the Treehouse videos and videos that other people put out from their captures at E3, and I was just hooked. And, you know, from that point on, I devoured every little bit of information that I could find. And so at work in my department, we have about six or seven of us who are all playing Breath of the Wild, all bring our Switches every day to work to play on our breaks and our lunches because we can. Oh, I love the portability of the Switch. Can I just repeat that?
It's so funny that you mentioned, like, the Treehouse thing, because I have done the same thing. I mean, in the last few months, I've been sick at home a couple of times, and, like, whenever I get sick, there's always the one thing that I can watch that makes me feel good. Sometimes it's Daredevil, sometimes it's Gilmore Girls, sometimes it's Sports Night. Like, it's just...
That's quite the spectrum.
Yeah, and it, like, has to be that specific thing. I don't know why. And Zelda was my thing these few times I was sick. And I've probably watched, like, 12 or 14 hours. And the crazy thing I just realized is all of that was on the Great Plateau.
Oh, yeah.
Which is, like, nothing.
Which is less than 2% of the entire game. So
do you, okay, not to spoil anything, do you play on the Great Plateau until you get that little, like, kite thing? And then that's what lets you escape?
So you have four shrines that you need to do to basically get your four main abilities that you're going to be using for the rest of the game. Mm-hmm. And then it says, okay, you got those four abilities, you kind of understand it. You understand a little bit about how this game works. Now go.
Yeah.
And looking at the map, the Great Plateau is like a little spot middle. Like, it's okay. It's like the center.
It's not that small though. It's quite big. Bigger than I expected the quote unquote tutorial area to be.
You could have just said no, John.
No, John.
It seemed really small compared to the rest of the map. Is what I'm trying to say is it's a big game. There's a lot to play. Big game. That's all I want. I just can't find the Goron sound, guys.
So one of the greatest things about Breath of the Wild for me is, like I said, we do have all these people in my department that we're all playing it at once, and just talking about the stories of, oh my gosh, did you hear about this? Is what happened to me. And, you know, we all are going and playing the exact same game, but we're all having completely different journeys and seeing completely different things and making the experience our own. And I think that's what Zelda Breath of the Wild is all about. It's about creating your own adventure, making your own story.
Yeah. Absolutely. It's so funny that we talk about the Great Plateau as, like, the quote-unquote tutorial area, because literally the whole there's no tutorial. You wake up, and that's it. Like, that is all of the instruction you get in the whole game, is you wake up, and it's like, okay, I guess I'll go outside. And then, it does this beautiful pan across the Great Plateau, and you're like, wow, it's so majestic, whatever. And then it, like, sort of centers on the old man, and he looks at you, and then walks away, and you're like, huh, I think the game is telling me to go see the old man. And I just turned around, climbed up a mountain, and went and started fighting bokoblins with a stick.
I did the same thing, and I got slaughtered, and I laughed.
I think part of, like, the beauty of the Great Plateau is, like Brady, me and a bunch of co-workers have been playing it together. We have a chat client at work, so we made, like, a room in there where we're all just talking Zelda. So even if we're not in the same room, we're all still talking Zelda through the workday. And there's... I think my favorite example of the Great Plateau is getting to the ice shrine where you get the Cryonis, because it's at the top of the mountain, and the mountain kind of presents, like, the first real environmental challenge because it's cold, right? So we're talking about how we went up in kind of, like, four different ways. Was that one of our friends went up there and just, like, ate apples every time, like, his heart went down. He's like, apple, 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 just until he got to the shrine. One of my other friends actually figured out the recipe
and got the warm doublet.
Yep. One of my other friends, he actually did cook stuff
with the peppers.
Yeah. And me, like an idiot, ran up the mountain carrying a torch. Because the torch keeps your body tempered. We'll do that. And I ran all the way up to the top of the mountain and met the old man up there. And he's like, "Aren't you cold? Here's the warm doublet." And so, like, we all talked about different ways that we either got the doublet or got to the thing. And it's like, we were like, holy crap. Like, this, there's just variety. There's no right way to do anything. I mean, I ran around with a torch to keep me warm, like.
And that's just the first couple hours of the game.
Exactly.
At which point it expands exponentially in variety.
Yeah.
So one thing I've got to say, again, I have not actually played the game, but like a good little girlfriend, I've been watching my roommate play it. And I will, oh man, I remember watching my roommate come across a Lynel for the first time.
Oh my gosh.
Now, talking about me being...
Wait, Lion? I thought you'd been saying Lion-O this whole time. I thought it was like a crazy...
No Sword of Omens. I'm sorry.
L-Y-N-E-L. Lionel.
Thunder. 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 Thundercats. Anyway, the Lionel, the... In the first Zelda game, very first Legend of Zelda, when you're going up and you're getting the white sword, at the top of the waterfall, there's a Lionel, a single one. And that thing will wreck you. It's stronger than any enemy that you've seen before. And again, we're talking about a game that is 2D graphics, just sprites on a screen, and it's the same size as you. There's no real visual indication that thing's going to be that strong. And holy crap. And then you watch, like I said, I watch my roommate playing, and he comes across a Lionel, and I'm like, what is that thing off in the distance? Oh, cool, it's a Lionel. Holy, holy, holy crap, that thing is huge. It just, like, gallops up and wrecked him.
One shot. It's funny that you mentioned that, because they kind of introduced the Lionel in the same way, because the first time you, like, the story takes you through it, you have to go up to the top of waterfall, and it's just there. It's, like, in its own area, there's a... It does this really cool thing. It doesn't do it a whole lot, but like in this particular instance, they tell you you have to get like thunder arrows to prepare for a thing that's going to happen.
Yes, actually, this is where my roommate was.
Yeah, so like, so you're going up and you start finding these arrows, and you're like, okay, I'm probably going the right direction, and you get there, and it's just there.
Uh-huh.
It's just wandering around, and if it spots you at a distance, it just starts shooting arrows at you. And they hurt. Like, on top of the fact that they're thunders, so they'll make you like drop whatever you're holding. They just take away all the few hearts that you have at that point if you're just going through the story. And after that, you're just kind of scarred for the rest of the game. You just don't want to fight a Lionel.
I started making a habit of just placing skull stamps on my map every time I saw a Lionel. That's skull exactly stamp and move on. Never come back here.
And the thing is, so can we talk about the moon thing? Is that okay?
Yeah, we can talk about the blood moon.
So there's a blood moon event that happens in the
game. Oh, yeah, this thing is rad.
So there's a blood moon, and so basically what happens is when the blood moon hits, you get a little cutscene. And it revives every enemy you've killed on the map.
Yep.
It just resets the map.
I'm going to call BS on that. Because, the only experience I have besides Ocarina of Time is Skyrim. And I think somewhere in between is Breath of the Wild. Or above, because it seems way cooler. It's a big pain to clear out some of those dungeons and some of those forts and stuff of all the bad guys. And then it just, every so many days, it just reset and you just, oh man.
I was fighting a Lionel the other day. I finally killed him. I went back and I was picking up his gear. I was like, I had his bow and was about to pick up his sword and got the blood moon.
Yeah.
I was like,
Oh my gosh.
Now I will kill you with your own weapons. Thank you very much.
There's a horse you can get, and this is something that happened to me. Was on the way to get this horse, there are two Lionels on the way. So I was preemptive and went and bought both the Lionels. I was like, okay.
Oh no.
Bought the two Lionels. Okay, we're good. I can just grab the horse and get out of here, no problem. I get the horse, tame it, and on the way back, get a blood moon. So both the Lionels are on my way back, and I'm just like, you don't trust me, horse, and I don't trust you.
So that's interesting. I watched Chris play a couple weeks ago for 4 hours.
Yeah.
And it was the most entertaining movie I've ever watched.
I feel a little bad about this, but literally, John came over and we played for, I don't know, like half an hour. And then he's like, you know, we could just do this for the rest of the day. And I said, well, okay.
I was holding my baby daughter, giving her bottles. We were sitting there just comfy playing. And Chris was playing Zelda and it was glorious. It was like a playable Miyazaki movie in my eyes because that's my experience with that art style. Anyway, he has this horse. He named it Tiny Pony. Oh, Tiny Pony was a good horse. He had three spurs. He was adequate. And I was like, oh, what a great guy. There's no Epona in this? No, this is Tiny Pony. Oh, that's great. Did you give him that name? Yeah, I did. And I was bonded with Tiny Pony. I was like, this is adorable. And then Tiny Pony fell off a friggin' cliff. Oh, no, Tiny Pony! And I said, wait, Tiny Pony can die? And Chris looked at me with no emotion. Oh, Tiny Pony can straight up die. And I was like, wait, Epona never died? Oh, but Tiny Pony can die. And so then 5 seconds later, he finds Zelda's horse and gets Zelda's bridle. And it's like, oh, this is a 5-spur. Oh, Tiny Pony, you're going in your stall for the rest of the game. And then we named Zelda's horse Pony Danza.
Yeah. Especially proud of that.
That's awesome. So
I gotta say, I'm sorry, my favorite moment from Breath of the Wild, watching my roommate play, just this one time, he's walking up a mountain, and all of a sudden a goat runs up out of nowhere and just smacks him in the face.
Knocks him off the mountain?
Yep. And that's wonderful. It. We never saw that goat again.
That's the whole plot of the floppy disk game Matterhorn Screamer by Disney. Goofy climbs up a mountain and gets knocked off really easily. I never beat that game. It weighs on me.
So one of the things that I absolutely love about this game is, you know, it's the first game that the first open world game that I've seen where you have all of these interconnecting systems where everything is working together and like complementing each other. And you get ideas in your head and the majority of the time it works out. So let me give you an example. So a few different systems working together for me.
Let me wave my nerd card really quick. The developers referred to this as multiplicative gameplay, which they have like multiple systems that end up working together.
They also refer to it as instead of a physics engine, it's a chemistry engine. Yeah. Okay. Quick plug for this before, because Aldo just barely mentioned it. If you haven't seen the YouTube video of their presentation at GDC, watch it.
I want that 2D version of Breath of the Wild badly.
They mocked up Breath of the Wild using the graphics and the sprites from Zelda, The Legend of Zelda for the Nintendo. And you can, like, in the game, you can watch Link burn down trees and then take the wood from the tree that he burned all the leaves off and turn it into a raft. And it's really incredible that they mocked this complex game engine in such simple graphics.
And like part of the really cool thing about that is that not only did it allow them to really kind of flesh out existing systems, it also let them experiment with things, you know, with not requiring a whole lot of development time. Were they able to see, this is a cool idea, will it work? Okay, no, we can scrap that. It only took like an hour of development time, right? And I think that's part of the reason why the game turned out so solid, is because they had these systems and really it was just translating them to 3D after that.
Seeing if it worked as a game first before making it work in their, you know, nice graphics. Well,
one of the crazy things that Nintendo did with this game and with their development is every time that they meet a big milestone, they basically said, okay, everybody, go and play the entire thing. And then come back with your feedback and we're ready to fix things.
Well, they had a week to play. Mm-hmm.
I think anytime anyone in this room says multiplicative again, you have to go.
Yeah, speaking of which, I think I hijacked Brady's story.
Oh, yes.
Please go on, Brady.
So my story. You know, one of the first times that I decided, okay, I'm actually going to take on a Lynel, I'm going to try to kill it, and I came up with this idea. And so, first of all, my favorite armor that I wear is the Sheikah armor.
It looks so cool.
It looks so cool, especially since like you can also dye your armor in the game, and I dyed my Sheikah armor all white, and it looks awesome.
He does say so himself.
But one of the bonuses that you get from that is stealth. You get a stealth bonus. And So I had the stealth bonus from wearing this armor. I was in the middle of a thunderstorm. And the thing about about a thunderstorm is if you have metal equipped, you will get hit by lightning.
Yep, you will.
You'll see a little spark that goes and hear a tss, 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 and then
does that kill you every time or mostly kill you if you have a lot of hearts?
How many hearts you have.
Yeah.
So. And what you're wearing.
So I decided I'm going to sneak up on this Lynel because I also have something that you get from one of the divine beasts that will bring you back to life. And I thought, okay, I'm going to sneak up on this Lynel. And I'm going to get it struck by lightning by just being near it. So I'm sneaking up, and I did not expect this at all, but I get a mount propped. So I'm like, I can mount a Lynel. Okay. And so I waited until I got the zzz, zzz, and then I mounted it and started, you know, slashing at it. And then got hit by lightning, so that both of us got hit by lightning. And the fact that I came up with that idea and that it worked flawlessly is just what this game is about. It's about adventure and discovery and figuring things out and then going back to your friends and going, oh my gosh, oh my gosh.
So I have to know, did it one-shot the Lynel?
Oh, no.
Okay.
No, it was a blue maned Lynel, which I think has lightning resistance anyway.
Oh man!
So it's kind of a bittersweet ending. Speaking of bittersweet endings in Zelda,
they all have lightning resistance because I had that same idea actually like a couple days ago, and I had a spear. So there's a little area in the world that's a Colosseum, and there's always a Lynel there. Depending on like how far you are in the game in terms of shrines or beasts or that Lynel will, I guess, evolve. So, like, you know, it'll be as hard
the,
as...
The wine, yeah.
Yeah. So where I'm at in the game, or at least at this point, which actually is where I'm at now, I've completed the game. So I have not seen, like, a normal red Lynel in ages. So all I have, like, these white ones. So I was like, you know, I can take it down. I'll just grab a spear, and I'll let the lightning thing start sparking, and I'll throw it at the last second, because you can do that. And I was doing that, and I threw it, and it hit the Lynel, and the lightning hit it, and the damage was just like, boop, just a little bit. I was like, all right, I'm gonna die.
Now, see, I've never played this game, but knowing that you can do this, even though it doesn't work, I have to do it now.
Also,
I have to, you know.
For sure.
Also, the other really cool thing, so that little Colosseum area, there's a Lynel in the middle of the Colosseum, and there's just a bunch of enemies around where, like, the seats technically are, right? So you can go and fight them. And I remember after this fight, during this fight, I was fighting the Lynel, you know, lightning's kind of hitting the Colosseum. It feels like a really epic boss fight. It's in the rain, it's at night, there's lightning.
You're in an actual Colosseum. Yeah.
I'm fighting this Lynel, my weapons are all breaking, I'm, like, down to, like, the bitter end. I defeat it.
Are you not entertained?
And I turn around, I'm like, wait a minute, there's all these, like, weapons just all over the place. So I start picking them up, and some of them start sparking, and I'm like, oh my goodness, the lightning that was hitting the Colosseum was hitting all the enemies in the stands.
That's and so killing cool!
All of them.
Oh my gosh.
What?
Oh, that's man. Awesome.
Yeah.
So I actually, as soon as I got off the Great Plateau, the first thing I did was go to the Colosseum. So I jump off and I'm like, huh, what's that thing? And so I climb all the way up the outside and I don't get hurt. And then I just kind of start hopping down and get, you know, almost wrecked by a moblin. Like first time seeing Lizalfos, you know, I'm just like running away and I get down to the bottom and there's a freaking Lynel. And I just run as fast as I can. And so then I like keep going down the road and I get to the... what is it? It's like the outer... It's one of the stables. I forget what it's called. And somebody at the stable is like, oh, hey, I've been hearing this story about, like, the legendary warrior and, like, how he has this sword. And she, it's like a side quest of, like, oh, you need to show this girl the master sword. I'm like, okay, so things to look forward to. And so just maybe, I don't know, last week sometime, I finally like got the Master Sword and just happened to be over by that stable and walked over and like showed the girl like, hey, I have the Master Sword. It was like this sort of culmination moment of like the very beginning of the game and like being way further in the game. And I'm like decked out in armor and everything. And I'm like, I have the Master Sword. What's up? And she's like, this is so cool. And then I realize the Colosseum's over there. And I'm like, I'm going to go wreck the shit out of that Lionel. And I just like walked in and destroyed him. And I was like, yeah, that's right. How do you like me
it's
now?
It's like coming back to high school and having grown a foot.
It's like going to your high school reunion and like being rich and being like, how do you like me now? Football team? No, thanks. I'm good.
There's a moment where the game kind of humbled me. And it was the first time I went to Hyrule Castle. I'm not going to get into a lot of specifics. Hyrule Castle is honestly my favorite part of the game. It feels more like a classic dungeon than any of the Divine Beasts.
That music.
Chris just ran us in there just to see what it was like.
Like, yeah. Really?
Oh, so scary.
So one of my favorite things, actually, being, quote-unquote, in the post-game, since I have a lot of, like, of the higher gear and stuff, it's just kind of going back in there and just uncovering all the secrets of the castle. Mm-hmm. But the first time I went and I was like, I'm gonna go finish the game. I go in, and I decide.
Did you go to the front gate or did you do something crazy?
No, I went through the back.
Okay.
Yeah, so there's like waterfalls and stuff.
Yeah.
Anyways, I don't want to get too super specific with it, but. So there's a part where I'm being chased around by like one of the guardian drones, the ones that are in the air. There's like a turret one off in the distance that there's no cover, so I'm just constantly being targeted.
I wanted to talk about those, hear more about them, but go on.
Yeah, so I'm getting targeted by two of these things.
Giving some atmosphere.
So I'm running away, and I'm like, okay, where's the front door? Because if I can just get into the boss fight, call it good, whatever. And I'm not able to get away from them, so I see like a hole in like a little building type thing, and I'm like, perfect, I'll go in there, there's cover from the two things. I go in and I fall off the ledge and I go into this building, and for the first time in like 60 something hours of playing Zelda, the doors lock. They close down and a Lionel spawns in the middle. Oh no. So I start fighting him, break like half my weapons as I'm like getting ready, because I'm gonna go fight Ganon.
So I have my weapons, or break, so you thought.
Yeah, so I punch him, like, oh no. So I do this, so I'm like, okay, I fight it, beat it. I'm like, half my food is gone, half my weapons are gone. I'm like, well, I gotta scrounge the castle more, be more prepared. I'm doing this, and the same thing happens to me a second time. There's like another building, and I walk in there, and the gate's closed. I'm like, no. Another Lionel. I'm like, the Lionels are the worst.
Well, that's such like a classic Zelda trope, too. Yeah. That like, they save for the end. That's so cool.
It's really so good.
When we went in to the castle the very first time, we were riding Tiny Pony.
Oh, he was a brave lad.
And I think we were chasing one of the memories.
Here's what I remember. You were like, you know, on the other side of the castle is a tower I should go to, and it's near this. We should go over there and uncover. Okay, let's do that. Well, we could just go to the castle. Well, okay. I remember everything being on fire.
Yeah.
I remember a lot of lava, and I remember, like, we had seen two, maybe three guardians, and the whole point, and like Chris had, like, you know, gone over the whole map, you know, little Pony Express just going everywhere. And we had seen a couple, and it was like, we better avoid those because they are bad. And there was like 100 of them just like lined up, just like, we're going to F you up. And then like flying ones, which we had never seen before. And then it was just like, and like he got cover, and then like, I don't even know what happened. We were like, it was a river of lava or something. Couldn't get any further.
We got to the moat, and I was just like, yeah, no. I'm like, let's turn back.
So I think Brady and I mentioned these. Well, I don't think it was on the podcast. I think it was off recording. We're talking about the mazes.
There's a couple areas.
There's three areas in the world that are mazes. And in one of them, it's the one by Akala.
Yeah, there's...
So you can go to it, and once you like find the treasure chest at the shrine in the thing, there's a little hole in front of the shrine that just has a constant updraft of air. And if you drop down in there, there's a chest. There's a bunch of decayed guardians just around you. And you're like, cool. Like, none of them are activating. None of them are attacking anything. So you go up to this chest. You open it. And next thing you know, the guardian music starts playing in the background. You start seeing all these red lasers.
Those are so scary.
Yeah, all the lasers start pointing at you. There's no way out except that hole that you came in.
Jeez.
But there's like guardians around that area, so you're just trying to survive. There's nothing there to like help you.
Is there nothing in the chest? It's just to turn them all on.
No, no, it's an item that actually helps give you like guardian resistance.
It's like 5 rupees. You're like,
that was worth it.
but that was like, that's actually been one of my favorite discoveries. It was like totally by accident because I found the treasure room in a different way. So when I got out of the shrine, I was like, where does this girl go in there? I'm like, oh no.
I immediately regret this decision. With the Forgotten Temple.
Yeah.
So I get to this place on the map and like I look on the map and it says Forgotten Temple and I'm like, let's check that out. And so I get there and there's nothing there. It's just like this weird, it's like flat and it looks like it's just like ruins and there's nothing there. So I just keep walking and walking and walking. And then I realize that I'm on top of the temple. And so I come down and I see the front of it and I go inside and like, it was just such a cool discovery of like, this is the most barren, like useless part of the map I've seen.
Yeah.
And it turned out to be the top of the temple. It was so cool when I went inside.
Have you guys done Eventide Island?
I just did yesterday.
Oh my gosh. Okay. So I do not want to spoil anything about this other than go to the southeastern corner. There's an island there. Go there and experience one of the coolest moments that I've ever had in gaming.
So good.
It totally caught me by surprise, too. I was...
Yeah.
Yeah.
I had no idea, because there's another smaller island right, like, a little bit north of it.
Mm.
And I was like, I'm going to go to that. Because it was early in the game. I was like, I can go to that. Like, that's the cool thing about this. I grabbed the leaf, pushed the little raft all the way out there, and I was like, yeah, did the thing. And then I saw Eventide Island, no idea what it was, went to it. Probably one of my favorite moments playing Zelda was that.
Oh, man.
And I was just like, this is great.
See, and I had kind of been holding off. I knew what it was. I kind of had the, you know, someone had told me what it was. And my buddy yesterday was like, dude, have you done Eventide Island? It was insane. I did this, this, and this. It was so hard. And I was like, all right, cool. I'll go check it out. And it's funny because I'm a lot further into the game than he is. I've just been playing a long time. And it's so hard to talk about this without talking about it. But like his story of what he did on that island is completely opposite of mine.
Yeah.
And it's so like,
but both are amazing.
Right.
And that's the thing.
And it's like, I wish I could say why it is that that's so cool for that thing specifically. But like the fact that we had such different experiences was amazing. I was sending him screenshots and all this stuff. Like, look what happened. And it's just like the knowledge that you gain throughout the game can just change your experience so dramatically.
I think the thing that also changes Eventide Island so much is also at what point in the game.
Yeah.
I went to it very early in the game, so...
Yeah, like 4 hearts or something.
Yeah, I had like six hearts, actually. But
see, just, that was totally different than my experience.
So the thing, I was just like, I can't. There's no way. How?
So good.
Man. Has anybody else run into the flower girl?
Yes. Oh my gosh, yes!
Let's talk about the NPCs in this game for a little bit.
Oh my goodness.
There are some amazing ones.
I'm sure we all have our favorites.
So, I remember telling my roommate to go step on the flowers. It's okay. Do it. Oh, just do it. Keep doing it. It's okay. Oh, just do it again.
Is it worse than chickens? Is it worse than killing chickens?
It depends on your definition of worse, because I'd probably say it's better.
Well, and it just, like, it's such a good example of the game encouraging exploration, which, we haven't talked about Korok seeds yet.
Oh, no.
Korok seeds are awesome.
Well,
I'm going to spoil something here because I don't think that anybody in this room or anybody with any sort of sanity will actually collect all 900 Korok seeds.
Oh yeah, spoil this.
So your reward for collecting every single Korok seed.
We should maybe explain like what a Korok seed is.
Okay, so
Korok seed is a small golden
seed with a peculiar spell.
Yeah. So Korok seeds. So they're basically the equivalent of, I would say, Riddler trophies.
Or golden skulltulas.
Yes.
Oh.
So they're essentially environmental puzzles that are scattered all over the world. There's no real indication except that something maybe looks kind of odd.
There's a circle of rocks, but it's not quite a complete circle.
And you get, the coolest thing about it is you get this like sixth sense for like, I bet there's a Korok seed here. And 99 times out of 100, it is.
Yeah.
It's so cool to just recognize it.
And the 100th time, it's a Lionel.
There's a lot of times.
I'll put this rock here, and all of a sudden, there's a Lionel in the middle of these rocks.
There's been a lot of times when I just look at the top of a mountain, and I'm like, I'm going to go there, and there's a Korok seed.
It's still exciting to me. I've gotten 100 of them. It's still like, yay!
So it's this thing that you do, and you can go, and you can find this character named Hestu. Who is trying to fill up his maracas with the seeds that you're collecting.
Wait a minute. You're climbing to the top of mountains to collect seeds for a guy's maracas.
Yes.
Mountains that will kill you if you don't have on warm clothing.
Yes.
Mountains that are full of Lionels that will kill you instantly.
Yeah.
Mountains that could have guardians on them that will fry you immediately.
Yes. Such is the love that Hestu engenders because of his
that is Hestu.
Magnitude.
Yeah, and so once you give Hestu...
I don't get it!
Once you give Hestu the seeds, he will help expand your inventory slots. So, he'll help you have more melee weapons, more bows, or more shields.
Okay, now I get it. Okay. I thought it was just for music's sake.
He does have a little thing, and then his captions or his subtitles, he subtitles every time you get an item, so that da na na na, you get a little.
It says da na da na.
Yeah. It's the best.
He does kind of look like this when you feed star bits to the star.
Also, the other really funny thing is you talk to him while you're naked. He's like, you're naked. I'm naked. We're naked.
He actually doesn't help you with your inventory at that point. He's just so obsessed
nakedness. So basically, your reward for collecting all 900 of these environmental puzzles is basically, he gives you this little golden thing that you can't do anything with it. And you look at it, and you look at the description, and you're like, he just handed me a golden poop. He handed me his poop.
And then you realize
that the Korok seeds are little Korok poops.
You've just been collecting little poops the whole time.
You're just running around collecting
I thought they were little green guys that held on to leaves, and they're like, hey, so that's
they have
a Korok.
Golden poops.
And the seeds are what you're collecting.
Yeah. And it's a poop.
They're little poops.
It's a little poop.
And I think I'm going to take this opportunity to springboard into one of the things I think has been most praised about Breath of the Wild is its approach to open world games. And we've all played Assassin's Creed. We all know the idea of you got to the top of the tower. Here's a to-do list of 900 things that you need to do now. And they're repetitive, horrible side quests. Oh my gosh. Follow this guy around and listen to his boring story.
But don't get caught.
Yeah. Oh. And Breath of the Wild doesn't do that. You climb a tower so that you can look around and see.
That looks interesting.
Yeah. I want to go do that. And I feel like the Korok seeds are the ultimate spin on that of look how cool it is. You can find a Korok seed anywhere. And it takes that gamer mentality of I have to get all the Korok seeds. I have to be a completionist. I'm going to get the best armor in the game or whatever. And you get to the end. It's like,
I like to imagine that somebody at Nintendo was like, you know, they like to collect crap.
Somebody took that very literally.
So let's springboard off of Hestu and I want to talk about some NPCs.
Yeah, sorry.
Because this game, with everything that you see about this game, you think this doesn't feel like
Zelda. Yeah.
You have all these different weapons and the weapons break and then you just get more weapons.
There's cooking.
You know, you have to be prepared for the environment.
There's skill trees to some extent.
There's puzzles. It just doesn't feel like Zelda. Until you start dealing with the NPCs, and then you see that Zelda quirk everywhere. And then the game goes, because this game is very, this game is very dreary. I would say that this is the most dreary. And
there's hardly any music most of the time.
I'd say that it's the most dreary Zelda game since Majora's Mask.
No, I don't think so at all.
Really?
I think it's really cheerful. It strikes a balance because you're alone. It's made very obvious by the fact that you don't have a whole lot of environmental music. So, like, you feel alone. But it doesn't feel dreary. Like, you don't talk to people and they're like, well, we're going to die in a couple days. Like, there's some people that are like, oh, look at that. The castle's on fire. Everything's on fire. I got to go find my wife.
Yeah, everyone's kind of living their own happy lives. Yeah.
And there's golden poop, Brady.
That's true.
And like, you go to the Zoras and they're like, well, it's raining just a little bit harder today. So.
But I think you're proving Brady's point is that all of those moments are with the NPCs, right? They're like the joy and the wonder of the world.
I don't think it feels nearly as dreary as...
Well, it's because like everything was destroyed 100 years ago.
Right, I don't know. I still don't think it's nearly. I think Link to the Past feels worse. Twilight Princess feels I just don't think it's nearly as sad as.
I think it. Well, and maybe this is just another testament to how differently you can play the game.
Yeah.
Like I love that balance too. One of the things I loved when we went to the castle was that, you know, we were riding around on Tiny Pony. We were like, there's not a care in the world, whatever, and trying to avoid guardians, whatever. But then you climb. You get into the castle grounds for the first time, and you see that town that has been ravaged, and it's on fire, and you just, like, you have, you know, there's that shot that ends up in the trailer of the guardians running down the streets, blowing up people's homes.
Those memories, just in general, are very, like,
grim.
Like, I actually had a tear come to my eye with one of the Mipha
Now, I mean, you want to talk about melancholy and the NPCs, which is a lesser-known Smashing Pumpkins album.
Let's just take a moment and appreciate that. Let's just take a moment.
Guys, it's after midnight as we're recording this. The few memories that I've seen with Princess Zelda, I'm going to say that, and that's like pretty much all I'm going to say about these. You get the impression that Zelda isn't happy, even before everything that happens with Ganon. And so I think there is enough of that Zelda quirkiness, and so many of these delightful characters that have a good sense of humor about them, that the game isn't, like, oppressive. But there certainly is this dreariness, because you are trying to fight and win a battle that you lost 100 years ago.
Yeah.
And you are... scrabbling back up from the ashes. It reminds me a lot, and we keep harping on this, it reminds me a lot of the first Zelda game.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But in addition to that, it also reminds me of Shadow of the Colossus.
Yeah. Yes, so, absolutely.
So yes, in retrospect, you are correct. It feels right. It doesn't feel depressing like Majora's or Twilight.
Well, let's talk about what makes it joyful, and that is these NPCs that are... Every NPC is so full of personality, and... Mm-hmm. Like, they react to so many different things. It's like taking all of the systems that they established in Majora's Mask, well, you know, everything from their schedules to the way that they react to you and things, and then just dialing it up to 11.
But it's not, though. Sorry, I haven't had a single side quest that made me feel like I was actually affecting people's lives.
What about Hestu?
He is so happy.
Hestu has affected my life. Sorry, it's kind of been the disappointing thing for me is that for as great as like the characterization moments, especially because the NPCs feel so full of life, the memories make all these characters feel so full of life. I feel like the story in general is kind of bland.
Well, you know, and it's
the world is a line, old
Anyway, I'm sorry.
Anyway,
let's talk about
the NPCs.
The game either, so we don't, you know, it's hard to judge.
My favorite NPCs. So my favorite NPCs are the kids.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Especially just the one that like the does town. The dance. He's like, ooh, Shaheen. That's great.
Or the ones that are, they're spies, right? They run around Hateno Village and they're like, we're spies. And you can just run around after them and they will run around the whole village playing. And it just feels so alive, like they're really doing stuff and not just standing in one place saying like, you know, I used to be an adventurer once, etc.
You hear about the kidnapping. The kidnapping, yeah, but the kid woke up. That's from Majora's Mask.
Oh, man. So Stephen kind of started this off by talking about the flower lady.
Yeah.
Which is just a lady who has wonderful. Planted a bunch of flowers around a shrine.
And she asks you very nicely not to step on them.
She does the first time.
And the second time.
By the fifth or sixth time, she's a little bit more forceful.
Did you guys talk to the... So one of the funny things, and the internet has certainly taken note of this, everybody wants Link. Like, everybody's...
Lonely Archer Girl.
That's a trope now.
That's where I was going to go. Lonely Archer Girl, which is also probably my new username on Twitter. She is hilarious and totally has the hots for Link.
And she's just in a journal entry, right?
No, she's there.
Really?
Was it Hateno or
It's Kakariko because she's the one who is separated from her husband because her husband is obsessed with chickens.
Yeah, but she talks about how like. Oh, they're separated.
She keeps on like saying when you talk to her, like I went and I bought all of the arrows, and then I went in and I talked to her, and she's like, "You must be some masterful archer."
It's better though, like, so she gives you a question, a little side quest. You're supposed to go turn on.
Can we talk about the journal? I feel like the journal is important to this story.
So you turn on these lamps. And you go back and she's like, oh my gosh, you gotta be really good at this. And then like at one point she's like, she's like, I wish somebody would pull my string. It hasn't been pulled in years. And I was like, ooh.
See, okay, this makes sense. Because I was like, I want to see a funny meme about Zelda. The first thing that pops up when you type in Lonely Archer Girl Zelda Breath of the Wild is Breath of the Wild the horniest Zelda?
Yes.
What?
No, I think Eurogamer did a video called Everybody's Thirsty for Link.
So what does the journal entry say? It's something along the lines of, like, there's this, like, the mythical heroes come back, and he must be an amazing archer. And it's like, I wish I could just watch him notch an arrow.
It's excellent.
So good. Oh, yeah.
Pia, who also really wants you, and like, if you go read her journal, she talks about how her heart starts, like, beeping a lot when every time you talk to her or stuff like that, she talks about how not beeping, beating faster. Yeah. How she can't form sentences. How she told Impa about it, and she was asking her for medicine, and she just laughed it off. So she went to go talk to like the general goods owner, and asked him for medicine, and he just laughed it off. And she's like, I don't understand why everybody's laughing at me every time I tell him my heart beats when every time Link is around. So, who also has a birthmark on her left butt cheek.
Oh, man.
I think it's such a good... So
can I talk about Robbie? I want to talk about Robbie for a second. So Robbie is the scientist. He's in a Coliseo, like the top northeastern corner of the map. And he's hilarious because, like, anytime that you ask him to introduce himself... He, like, builds up to you know, introducing his name, and he'll, like, do this little dance, like, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And then as soon as you hit A, Robbie, and, like, a guitar chord plays.
Nice.
And it's awesome. But what I really love is his wife loves him, but hates his robot that he made, because he named the robot after his first wife.
Yeah. Sherry, yeah. Also, on that note, the other scientist, what's her name?
Oh, Pura? Something
Pura,
like that?
Yeah, Pura, who experimented on herself. So she's also like Robbie, where they're both kind of old, super old people. Except Pura experimented on herself, and now she's super young.
Yeah.
She's super energetic, and she's super anime.
She is crazy. That's the part of the game I watched. Yeah, was that part of the Impa?
Because you talk to her missions. And she introduces herself and she yells like Genki, does the peace signs, does a little anime pose, And you're just like, this is the most adorable thing ever. Till you realize she's like 100 and something years old. And you're like, oh, wait a minute. This is Zelda, I remember.
Well, yeah. And I think, and like, I guess we've been, so it's past midnight. We've been talking about wrapping up. Yeah. But the computer battery dying was like our sign. But I think that to kind of bring that around to a more general theme is like, I think this in better than any other Zelda game mixes the Japanese and the Western gaming traditions. Like, if you kind of before the first trailer, when all we saw was footage from the Great Plateau, it was like, oh, Nintendo made Skyrim. Like, that's really weird. Like, Nintendo made a Western RPG. And then they've also mixed in, like, I think it's almost like one of the most Japanese Zelda games, too.
Oh, yeah.
Like,
yeah.
There's just so much of that Japanese storytelling and influence and design and, like, everything about it. And yet they mix those two things together better than any game I can think of.
There's this beautiful middle ground, too, where, like, you get those Nintendo quirks. Yeah. Where, like, any game will have, like, a spear thing, right? And obviously you get very anime in the fact that, like, you can charge it up and he does, like, 20, like, strikes, you know, mm-hmm. and whatever. But there's also that little Nintendo quirk that if you have, like, certain Zora spears on your back while you're in the water, it gives you an attack. So you can be swimming.
Really?
Yeah. So you can be swimming and he'll do, like, a little... He'll do, like, a barrel roll in the water.
Barrel roll.
With the spear that's just equipped on his back. So, like, you have, like, this mixture, and then you have, like, this really beautiful kind of quirky Nintendo middle ground where it all just kind of meets, and you're like, oh, of course it would. Like...
Yeah, and, like, I'm 80 hours in, and that's news to me.
Yeah, like,
that's crazy.
I never heard of that.
Like, the Zora spears, like, specifically. Or, like, any spear, if you're on horseback... If you hold the attack button, he'll just start swinging it.
The Bokoblins do.
Yeah.
Oh man.
You've wasted your
guys.
Time.
It's such a good game. Like,
okay, so I think it's about time that we need to wrap up, but I think that we have time for one more story each of just something amazing that happened that encapsulates your entire experience.
Yeah. So okay. So. One thing I've failed to mention that has been the highlight of owning the Switch, honestly, is that I got it. I have a 5-year-old and a 2-year-old. They were pretty excited about, like, oh, this new cool thing, you know. My 5-year-old is really funny. She has a really hard time figuring out where her thumb should go, and she's holding the Joy-Con the wrong way. And then my 2-year-old, I hand her the Joy-Con, and it was like she had played video games for years. Like, she just picked it up, put her, like, one thumb on the joystick, one thumb on the buttons. I was like, ah, yes, you are the chosen one. And so they really like Snipperclips, and then I started playing Zelda with them. And my daughter... Why, I figured that I'd show her the horses. And I'd be like, oh, well, let's dress up the horse. And after that, every day this week, I've come home from work and she says the best words I've ever heard in my life, which are, Daddy, can I watch you play Zelda?
He texted me and I was like, you figured it out.
Yeah.
You figured out the key of parenting to get to do what you want.
I'm now in the
end game. And have your kids enjoy it. Yeah.
It's just been awesome. And so we spent 20 minutes cooking the other day and she said, well, what if you get a mushroom in this? And I'm like, there's no way this will work. And I came up with this awesome recipe. And so I was playing with her and I had a bunch of other stuff I wanted to do. I wanted to go find some memories. And there was a memory, the very last memory, I'd been looking for it for probably a week or a week and a half, like just poring over the images and like looking at the map and trying to figure out, well, there are like 4 trees in this picture and maybe their shape can, like, I haven't wanted to use guides, but I really was looking for it. And I ended up, like, I'm playing with my daughter and I'm like, really, like, I really want to find this memory. And she's like, no, let's not do that. Let's go to your house. Let's go buy a house, whatever. I'm like, ugh, fine. Okay. So, like, we go to the house and then we kind of wander around. And then I find these, like, gorgeous, like, solid color horses, which are, like, the really great horses in the game. And I had finally figured out that if you just spam on the L button, you can tame things really quickly. And so I got a horse and, like, it's a really nice horse. I was like, okay, so where's the nearest stable? And I just ride to the nearest stable. It's this gorgeous ride. And my daughter, like, loves watching it. And
as I'm approaching the stable, I look around and I realize this is it. Like, I've been looking for this thing for a week and a half, and suddenly, because I was off doing something else, like, and just happened across it, and I go, this is where the memory is. And it was, like, something I've never experienced in a game before, of just, like, happening upon something and being, like, I don't know, I was overwhelmed of, like, oh my gosh, this is the place, you know? And being able to go find that memory and then unlocking this incredible, and you've done the memories,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Like, that last memory is just breathtaking. Oh, and yeah, it was just like, that was one of my favorite parts of the game, and it happened just because I happened to be doing something else, and like, mm-hmm, there it was. It's, and that's just the story of the game for me, is this, yeah, endless, you know, discovery, which is really cool.
I think for me, one of the biggest moments about this, you know, I've kind of talked about some of my favorite stories already. What with the Lynels in the castle, me and my friends, and how we all got up the mountain different ways and that type of stuff. But I think for me, the thing that has kind of defined it the most was when we were reading, one of us was reading online, and we found out that you can get Epona through the Smash Brothers Link amiibo. If you have that, you can just summon Epona, you'll have it, and like, that's the thing. And so we spent about 3, 4, 5 days scouring the internet just to find the freaking amiibo. It's all sold out. And I remember I had a friend, I asked if we could borrow it, so we went out. We're borrowing it, sitting in the office, we have a communal amiibo pile in the middle of our team room of Zelda amiibos that we found and scoured and just kind of have collected and hoarded. So every day we get to work, we do our daily amiibo scan.
Mm-hmm. We do the same thing, it's awesome.
Yeah, and so, you know, we all have Epona, we're all like slowly collecting all these other stuff you can get through the Zelda amiibos, and like, one of our friends came into our team room and they were just like, is this just a bunch of Zelda amiibos? We're like, yeah. He's like, okay, left, came back with his Switch and just sat there and started scanning them, and it was like, this is like high school, this is like junior yeah, high, like when Pokemon came out, when you had your portable games, you're talking shit, telling each other like the secrets, the stuff you found out, you're just like, this is the thing, now we're all sharing amiibos, and like, for a very single player experience game, the experience of playing has been anything but a mm-hmm, single player experience. It's been mm-hmm, a communal thing, talking to people, finding stuff out, you know. You've mentioned that, I'm pointing at Chris and Brady. We're not looking up guides, or we're trying to avoid looking up guides as much as possible. And I think we all have like our own pockets of friends where we're just like talking to each other and just finding stuff out.
I live on like, the Breath of the Wild subreddit. Like every day I'm checking that out. Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's where I live. Like on the weekends, or like at night, then I'll take that information over to my friends at work and like, they'll talk about the stuff they found. And that's kind of been the magic for me. Kind of the best story about Zelda was having a communal amiibo pile.
And just some random guy was like, oh, hey, amiibo pirate, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I just found out this last week that there was a video game Slack channel at work. And I was like, oh, all right, like, nice. Let's talk. How's everybody doing? Yeah.
So, for me, one of the experiences that really defined this Breath of the Wild just completely is one of those moments where you just look at the top of the mountain and you're like, I wonder what's up there.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I won't say what mountain it is, so that you can go and find it yourselves. But I, you know, I struggle and I get to the top of the mountain, and this was actually pretty early in my playthrough.
Did you fight the Lynel?
No. This is something different. But as I get to the mountain, and as I'm going up, I'm like, those are some weird looking crystals at the top of this mountain. And then I get closer, I'm like, those aren't crystals. That's a freaking dragon that's wrapped around the top of the mountain. And then you get to the top and basically you hear a voice that says that this dragon has been corrupted. And you look and you see these corruption spots with eyes, and you're supposed to shoot the eyes, you know, because, and you run into that in the dungeons and stuff. and cleanse the dragon. I'm like, okay, so shoot one.
That is the hardest yoga pose of all, is cleansing the dragon. Go on.
So you shoot. So I shoot the first one, and I did not have many arrows. I'm like, oh crap, I don't know how I'm going to do this. And of course, it woke the dragon up, and it starts flying, and it goes up further on top of the mountain. So I chase it up the top of the mountain, take aim, get another one, and then it starts going down the mountain. And so I'm paragliding, chasing after it, doing my arrows. And I have my last arrow, and there's only one eye left. I aim, and I miss.
Oh.
And at this point, like, I'm, you know, half a mile up off the ground, you know, above this dragon. I'm like, crap. I am completely out of arrows. And so I look down at it. I'm like, you know what? The eye's on top. And so I'm like, okay, here we go. And I timed it, and I just took out my sword, you know, from gliding, and just boom, nailed it.
Nice.
And then, you know, did my glider before I hit the ground to save myself, and barely had enough stamina. And then you go up on top of the mountain, and you go to you get a shrine for that, and then leaving that shrine, and it was morning, and it was a sunrise, and I just sat there and basked in the beauty of this sunrise
at the top of a very tall mountain
yeah. After just fighting a freaking dragon and ending it the way that it did.
Surfs the robot Dracula down from his moon base and lands and basically gives the finger to all of the state of Maryland.
Yeah.
I got the same vibe.
But beautiful. That beautiful moment of tranquility after that amazing experience that I just had, that is what defines this game to me. It's a moment that will really stick out to me. And it's, and the thing is, like, you know, I've always loved video games, but I've been kind of falling off a little bit lately. Just not really having much of a desire. I mean, Overwatch got me excited for a little while, but that was most of last year what I had. And not until this game did I feel like I was a kid again. Did I feel like I was part of something bigger than myself? For the first time, probably since Ocarina of Time. Since Ocarina of Time and Final Fantasy VI. Like, this was the first time that I had that feeling of, this is important. This is special. And, you know, I still haven't fought Ganon. I'm a little over 50 hours in. I've gotten all four Divine Beasts. But I've played enough where at this point I can say with a certainty that this is my favorite game of all time. And it's something special. And it's something that is kind of defining in my life, this art. Mm-hmm. And it's something that I will remember for the rest of my life, and I will hold dear for the rest of my life. And I'm going to be talking about this game for decades to come, because it is that damn good.
Yeah. And it really, like, it just feels like, you know, every single person that worked on it just poured their heart into it. Like, they're just the smallest things that you find where, you know, it's such a cliche to say, like, oh, every blade of grass is purposefully placed. But, like, really just the size of the world and the way that everything fits together and culminates in these amazing moments is just, like, it's just so impressive. It's amazing. It's just this masterpiece of a game.
Go ahead, Steve. You were leaning forward. You were leaning forward towards the microphone.
I was reaching for my Kleenex.
Well, I've composed a little song about how I feel about this game. Bravely Tiny Pony roamed off the great plateau. He was not afraid to die, Brave Tiny Pony. He was not at all afraid to be killed in nasty ways. Brave, brave, brave Tiny Pony. He was not the least bit scared to ride off of a cliff, or to have his head cut off, or all four legs broken. He was not at all afraid to be replaced by a better horse. Brave, brave, brave Tiny Pony. It's a work in progress. It's not bad, but, you know, it's a great game, guys. from what I've observed.
Yeah, the fact that it's got the two of us who have not actually played it so excited, I think that does say something about it.
It's, you know, and I don't say this lightly because I would hardly ever call a game a system seller. Like, you have to buy a video game system just for this one game. But honestly, Zelda is a system seller for the Switch. And I think that Zelda is the reason why it is, why the Switch is so in demand just everywhere. Mm-hmm. And it's impossible to find. I have so many friends who are constantly looking and checking every sort of app. And
you hear about people that sell their Switches for like $600 or like $900. I have a friend that actually paid $600 for the Switch so he could play Zelda while we were all playing Zelda. Because he was like, I can hold off. I can wait, you know, a few months maybe. And we all started talking about it. And within the week, he was like, I just went on eBay. And I did it.
I mean, if you're a huge gamer, I mean, there is a community aspect to it, I would guess, that you want to be part of, you know, that.
You want to be part of that zeitgeist.
Not get into it later, yeah.
Yeah, I would put up in my, you know, like, I don't know, in the same category with, like, Mario Brothers 3, A Link to the Past, Mario 64, like, I can't think of any other game to, like, honestly compare it to in the way that it's just, like, a whole new level of game.
Yeah, it's up there with Twisted Metal 2 for me, man.
Yeah.
You know, this game is so good that I'm okay with Mass Effect Andromeda sucking. Because now I don't have to worry about playing that for a very long time.
I paid $120 for the collector's edition of Horizon Zero Dawn. I am totally okay that I've only played like 3 hours of it because I have been playing Zelda.
Oh, man.
I can't even go back to Horizon. Yes. Just sit
there. So good, it'll ruin other games for you.
I seriously, like,
it's ruined me for other open
games. I realized, you know what? Oh, crap. I haven't downloaded the PlayStation Plus and Xbox games with gold for the month yet because I haven't turned on those systems at all because why? I have Zelda and that's what I want right now.
I think no matter what happens with the Switch, like even if the Switch ends up being a flop like the Wii U, like it'll always be remembered for being the Breath of the Wild machine. Like it will always have its own little special place in history, I think, for that.
And I think that will about do it, guys.
Thank you for tuning into part 7 of our Breath of the Wild podcast.
And your reward for listening to the whole thing is you finally get to go to bed. Oh, wait, that's just me.
Here's your imaginary Korok poop. It's golden.
Enjoy.
Woo! Wait a minute.
What?
Oh, wait. John's got a thing. The thing? Thing?
I found it!
Oh my gosh.
Oh.